His newest book is Lincoln at Cooper Union, The Speech That Made Abraham Lincoln President. In depth, Harold Holzer, live June 6th at noon Eastern, 9 Pacific. Book TV, every weekend on C-SPAN 2.
A House subcommittee today looked at research into Gulf War illness. Members heard from veterans of the Gulf War, as well as researchers and military representatives. This is about 3 hours and 40 minutes.
Thank you, I'm sorry. A quorum being present, the Subcommittee on National Security, Emerging Threats, and International Relations hearing, entitled Examining the Status of Gulf War Research and Investigations of Gulf War Illnesses, is called to order. Last weekend, in dedicating the World War II monument and celebrating Memorial Day, we acknowledged our profound obligation to those of past generations who made noble sacrifice in the service of liberty. That same duty to remember demands our focus today on another overdue national remembrance. The living warriors of this generation who fought in Operations Desert Shield and Desert Storm need just one thing written in stone, a sustained commitment to research and treatments for the mysterious maladies and syndromes triggered by battlefield exposures, and they cannot wait 60 years for their deserved testimonial to become a reality. This subcommittee, with oversight purview of the Departments of Veterans Affairs, VA, and the Department of Defense, DOD, today convenes our 17th hearing on Gulf War veterans' illnesses. Over the last decade, we followed the hard path traveled by sick Gulf War veterans as they bore the burdens of their physical illnesses and the mental anguish caused by official skepticism and intransigency. It was their determination that overcame entrenched indifference and bureaucratic inertia. Their persistence and a home video of chemical weapons munitions being blown up at Kamacia eventually persuaded DOD and VA that post-war illnesses are linked to wartime exposures. But characterizing the subtle linkage between low-level toxic assaults and varied chronic health consequences remains a dauntingly complex research challenge. As we will hear in testimony today, efforts to map uncharted neurological pathways between sarin-induced brain damage and diverse manifestations of illnesses are made even more difficult by unreliable exposure data. The dimensions of Gulf War syndromes may be obscured by epidemiological conclusions based on unreliable exposure estimates and plume models. And promising research hypotheses and treatment concepts still face institutional obstacles to federal support as both funding and momentum behind Gulf War illness research appear to be waning. So we asked our witnesses to give us their assessment of the status and future direction of Gulf War research. As in the past, we asked veterans to testify first. Their perspectives always inform and enrich our subsequent discussion, and we sincerely appreciate the patience and forbearance of our government witnesses in agreeing to sit on our second panel. Just as the liberation of Kuwait was an international mission, the search for post-war causes and cures has been a coalition effort as well. Over the years, we have been fortunate to be able to form a close collaboration with our counterparts in the United Kingdom. Continuing that transatlantic partnership, we are joined today by the Right Honorable Lord Morris of Manchester. Lord Morris is a leading advocate for Gulf War veterans in Britain and a strong voice behind the breakthrough research needed to solve the mysteries of exposure-related diseases. This is not the first time Lord Morris has joined us. 2 years ago, he and his colleague from the House of Commons, Mr. Bruce George, added invaluable insight and focus to our discussion, so much so that their obvious depth of knowledge and rhetorical flair made some of us feel a little intimidated and, believe it or not, tongue-tied. They were just so witty and engaging. So when we invited Lord Morris this year, we commoners asked if he would be just a little less lordly today, and he graciously agreed. He is a valued colleague of ours and a true friend to Gulf War veterans of all nations. Welcome, Lord Morris. You honor the subcommittee again with your presence, and we look forward to your continued contribution to our work. And we welcome all the panelists, all the individuals in both panels. We thank them for being here as well. And at this time, I would recognize Mr. Sanders, who has been at the forefront of this issue at probably all 17 hearings and probably some hearings I didn't even know about. Mr. Sanders.
Thank you very much, Chris, and congratulations to you and your staff for doing something that's very important, and that is reminding the men and women who are suffering from Gulf War illness that we have not forgotten and we are not going to give up on this issue. I think in many ways, when we look back on the history of how our country has treated veterans, whether it is exposure to radiation after World War II, whether it's Agent Orange from Vietnam, or whether it's Gulf War illness, I think many veterans understand that the United States government, DOD, and the VA have not done all that they could to protect veterans who come home from war with one or another illness. And it's no secret, if one reads the transcripts, that I have been less than impressed by the work of the VA and DOD in responding to the pain. What Chris has just said is that time after time, meeting after meeting, we have heard people coming up here talking about terrible ailments. I have held a number of meetings in the state of Vermont, a small state that did not send huge numbers of people over to the first Gulf War, and we heard from hundreds of people who had one or another serious problems. Also, what is important about this whole debate is if we can get a better understanding of the causation of Gulf War illness and the impact that chemical exposure has on human health, we're going to learn a heck of a lot in terms of civilian problems as well. This is not just the military problem. There's a lot to be learned about how people in this country who are not in the military become ill as well. So there is a great deal of work to be done. We're very pleased that our friends from the United Kingdom are here, and we thank the guests who are going to testify and our friends in the military for being here as well. So thank you very much, and I'm pleased to be here.
Thank you, Mr. Sanders. At this time, the chair would recognize the vice chair of the committee, Mr. Turner, who has been a real gift to this committee. We thank him for being here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate your convening this hearing today and for your continuing effort on focusing on the Gulf War illness. I know that your work is to ensure our veterans receive the treatment and medical care they deserve, and also that there's some very important correlation between the work and study of the Gulf War illness and the issues that this committee faces in homeland security and national security. We all know that the men and women of the U.S. Armed Forces fought bravely in the Gulf War, and they worked to disarm Iraq. Many ammunition bunkers and warehouses were destroyed by coalition forces, and many times the forces did not know what they were destroying. Only years after the war did we learn that some of these bunkers may have contained chemical nerve agents, thus exposing these troops to various levels of toxins. Thank you. The science and modeling that is being utilized in determining the root causes of this illness, I think, is very important to us as we look to our attempts at protecting both civilian populations and our military populations as we face not only further conflicts in the Middle East, but in protecting our homeland. It's interesting to me how many times we sit in hearings where with great certainty, people tell us what the effects will be of a certain type of terrorist attack or a certain use of weapon. But in this instance, we struggle in trying to determine what had occurred and what the effects would be in determining what the outcome had been. We have a lot to learn from this process, not just in looking at protecting our veterans, but also in the future of protecting our men and women in uniform and also our communities. Thank you.
Thank the gentleman. At this time, the chair would recognize Mr.
Yes, also, Mr. Chairman, thank you for your continued dedication to this issue and all members on the committee who have worked hard to keep this issue alive. There were many veterans of the Gulf War fighting an uphill battle here at home to get their symptoms recognized and diagnosed and to get service-connected disability ratings and to get the support they needed to move forward with their lives. Now, I'm grateful for that Congress was able to respond and enact legislation to complete research, to speed up ratings, and to compensate veterans. I'm also encouraged that we are continuing to hold hearings like this one to make sure that these veterans are properly cared for and to make sure we learn the lessons we as a nation need to learn to prevent future veterans from facing the same health care battles. I realize the main focus for today's hearing will be on continued research, the money promised and invested in research. Research is certainly an important part of the puzzle here, but as the newcomer to the issue and one who prefers to get to the bottom line, I'm most interested in three specific areas. One, after spending time and money on research for many years, now what have we learned? Two, where are we in relation to treatment? Are we helping the veterans, and are any of them getting better? Three, what lessons have we learned? Is our record keeping better? Are our troops getting better physicals prior to deployment and follow-up? Do we have the right people on the ground to conduct the experiments needed should an event occur so we have the science needed to diagnose and treat them? I think today's hearing is important for many reasons. First and foremost, the veterans of the Gulf War answered the call of duty, and many of them came home sick. We owe them the best we can to find out why and to help them feel better. Second, we have troops today in the same part of the world for much longer periods of time. After so many hearings on disparity of health care for National Guard and Reserves versus active military personnel, I'm worried we have not learned enough from the Gulf War lessons. Illnesses to prevent another situation on a grander scale. Look forward to hearing. Unfortunately, I have another hearing. I will be back, but I want to make sure for the record that my questions will be presented. And I also want to acknowledge Lord Mars. The UK has been a great ally to the United States throughout history, and it's an honor for you to be sitting on the same dais. Thank you, Lord.
I thank you, Mr. Rupersberger, and thank you for those questions. I think both panelists can know that they've already been asked and can respond, maybe even in their statements. They're very important questions. Before recognizing the panel, I ask unanimous consent that all members of the subcommittee be permitted to place an opening statement in the record and that the record remain open for 3 days for that purpose, without objection, so ordered. I ask further unanimous consent that all witnesses be permitted to include their written statement in the record and without objection, so ordered. I further ask unanimous consent that the Right Honorable Lord Morris of Manchester be extended the parliamentary privilege of sitting with the subcommittee today and participating, and without objection, so ordered. And in fact, before I recognize the panel, I would now recognize Lord Morris.
Congressman Shays, I count it an honor as well as a privilege to have been invited again to join members of the subcommittee on the dais for hearing of profound significance for veterans, US and British alike, of the first Gulf conflict. Troops from our two countries fought shoulder to shoulder in liberating Kuwait, and it's highly appropriate that members of our two parliaments should be seen acting together in addressing the problems and needs of veterans of the conflict now in broken health. I've served in the British Parliament since 1964, first in the House of Commons for 33 years, representing the city of Manchester, not Manchester, New Hampshire, but Manchester in Lancashire, England, the mother of all Manchesters, all nine of them, all over the world. And since 1997, I've been in the House of Lords as Lord Morris of Manchester. My involvement in Gulf War illnesses arose from my role as Honorary Parliamentary Advisor over many years to the Royal British Legion. And I was a founding member in 1964 of the Legion's Interparliamentary Gulf War Group, which comprises parliamentarians of the main political parties in the UK, distinguished medical specialists, researchers, legal experts, and representatives of the ex-service organizations, as well as servicemen and women who fought in the conflict. The Ministry of Defense is also represented. The Gulf conflict was on a scale bigger than any British troops had been involved in since the Korean War 40 years before. It was also the first since 1918 against an enemy known to have chemical weapons readily available for deployment. Thus, the Ministry of Defense had to prepare for the liberation of Kuwait on the assumption that such weapons would be used. Indeed, millions of people across the world had seen for themselves in TV reporting the stark effects of Saddam Hussein's use of chemical weapons against the civilian population of a neighboring Muslim country only months before the invasion of Kuwait. On November 9, 2001, George W. Bush said of Al-Qaeda that they were, and I quote, seeking chemical, biological, and nuclear weapons. 11 years before then, British troops deploying to the Gulf faced an enemy who not only possessed, but had already used some of these weapons, first for the massacre of Kurds in Halabja in 1988, and then against the civilian population of Iran in 1990. Aware of the weapons facing the coalition troops in the Gulf, the Ministry of Defense gave high priority to doing all they could to safeguard them against the effects of their use. It correctly assessed the threat facing British troops, but not all the health risks of the measures taken to protect them. Congressman Shays, while these measures were thought to be in their best interests, over 5,000 of the British troops deployed, all of them medically A1 in 1990 and 91, have reported illnesses. And they and their medical advisors are convinced were related to their service in the Gulf. The jury has now been out for nearly 14 years on the causes of still medically unexplained illnesses of our veterans. And I believe this hearing can take us nearer to resolving some of the issues involved, not least that of the scale of the effects of the destruction by coalition forces of the huge Iraqi stockpile of chemical weapons at Camp Isaiah in March 1991, releasing sarin and cyclosarin, as undoubtedly it did. The Legion describes veterans with still undiagnosed illnesses as having had, and I quote, a long, hard fight to have them accepted as war-related. Although epidemiological studies initiated by the MOD confirmed that our troops who served in the Gulf were more likely to be unwell than their peers who didn't, full official recognition of their needs has been, in the words of the Legion, difficult to achieve. And while they and other associations have had many successes in promoting veterans' interests, there is continuing concern in Britain's ex-service community that too many lessons of the first conflict are still to be resolved. In seeking a full public inquiry into the issues raised by the illness, the Legion could not be accused of acting precipitately. It did so in May 1997, 6 years after the conflict ended, not only in fairness to those afflicted, but to maximize public confidence that our troops would be fully prepared and protected in future deployments. But we still await an independent inquiry, and this too makes the subcommittee's hearing so important to British as well as American veterans. Congressman Shays, the Legion is acting in keeping with its highest traditions in continuing to press for an independent inquiry. They fully accept that mistakes made in 1990-91 were not deliberate. They know as well as anyone in executive government that decisions about protective measures often have to be made on a needs-must basis. But they rightly insist, and will go on insisting, and believe that any independent inquiry worthy of the name would strongly insist that the nation as a whole, not just the sick veterans and their families, must play its part in meeting the cost of such decisions. None of us at Westminster, any more I'm sure than anyone in Congress or executive government in the United States, wants to see the afflicted and bereaved of the Gulf conflict made to suffer the strain and hurtful and demeaning indignities that protracted delay in dealing with their concerns can impose. Yet sadly, many veterans feel that such delay has occurred, and their public representatives on both sides of the Atlantic must go on pressing for the truth about their illnesses. Colleagues, of all the duties it falls to parliamentarians to discharge, none is more compelling than to act justly to citizens who are prepared to lay down their lives for their country and the dependents of those who do so. There was no delay in the response of our troops in the call of duty in 1990-91, nor should there be any further delay now in discharging in full our debt of honour to them. For parliamentarians, you could say, every day should be a memorial day.
I thank the gentleman very much. And at this time, I'll just recognize the panel. We have Mr. Jim Bunker, Chairman Veteran Information Network, Gulf War Veteran, Topeka, Kansas. Dr. Derek Hall, Gulf War Veteran, United Kingdom. Dr. Janet Heinrich, Director, Healthcare Public Health Issues, U.S. General Accounting Office. Dr. Keith Rhodes, Chief General Accounting Office Technologist, U.S. General Accounting Office. Mr. Jim Binns, Chairman, Research Advisory Committee on Gulf War Veteran Illnesses. Mr. Steve Robinson, Executive Director, National Gulf War Resource Center, Inc. I would ask the panelists to stand, and at this time I'll swear them in. Raising your right hand, please. You solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you will give before the subcommittee will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Note for the record, our witnesses have responded in the affirmative, and I thank them for that. I'm going to, I think we have been somewhat generous in comment time. We do a 5 minute and then we trip over another 5 minutes. I'm going to really ask you to stick a little close to 5 minutes because we have a lot of panelists and we also have two panels. And also, Mr. Turner, your mic is not working, so we need you to shift down one or come on the other side of Bernie here, I think. So at that time, Mr. Bunker, you have the floor. And we have a light system which goes from green to yellow. It's kind of on the other side of Dr. Hall. Green to yellow to red. If you run a speck over 5 minutes, we won't lose sleep, but not much longer. Okay? Thank you. Thank you all for being here. You need to turn your mic on. I think the button will show a red if you just press down on it. Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, Lord Morris, members of the committee, on behalf of the Veterans Information Network and myself, I'd like to thank you for giving me time to address the issues of Gulf War illness and the research problems. I formed the Veterans Information Network with a group of veterans to help get legislation passed within the state of Kansas. This legislation led to the creation of the Veterans Health Initiative and also the funding of a research within Gulf War veterans of the state of Kansas. The unprecedented study was done by Dr. Leah Steele and is best known as the Kansas Study. The Kansas Study is the first to identify a clear link between Gulf War veterans' health problems and the time and place in which they served. Results suggest that the unexplained health problems may be due to multiple factors. The study is also significant in that it showed that for 0.1% of the money that the VA had spent on Gulf War research to that date, that the state of Kansas had came up with more answers and was able to show more on the illnesses affecting the Gulf War veterans than the DEA, than the VA or DOD ever did. This also shows that a state program that is set up right can better utilize the research funding versus the DOD and the VA. This study has also made Kansas the clear leader when it came to Gulf War illness research. The funding in this study also shows that there are several issues that need to be addressed with regards to the care and the health of the troops. The following are my recommendations based on the work done in Kansas. One, separate research away from the VA and DOD. It seems as though it takes an independent entity before meaningful results in studies will be conducted, as the Kansas study and other independent study research has shown significantly the problems within the Gulf War veterans versus those from the DOD or the VA. These independent studies have shown that we need to take the research away from the VA and the DOD and let state or private researchers do the work. The VA's Research and Advisory Committee, or RAC Board, could potentially work as a bridge that could be responsible for the funding independent research. This needs to be done For far too often, they ask the VA to fund studies to help the veterans, only that the studies are never funded by the VA itself. The RAC is in a unique position to hear about new and innovative studies from the researchers and have the potential abilities to guide exploration into previously unaddressed areas of research into the illness of Gulf War veterans, while having a historical perspective of what research has already been done. I suggest this in the hope that we would not continue funding research that has already been done. Essentially, the RAC would still have to work as it is now, but with the added power of being able to direct the spending of the VA, not just recommending research. Further, they would be the overseers of the money that has been spent in the studies. They would have access to the interim data of the studies and the power to withdraw the funding or terminate the study if the study is not following the protocol which it was submitted, protocol as written in the proposal for the funding that the researcher wanted. Get the illnesses that are being diagnosed at a higher rate in Gulf War veterans, presumptive service connected for these veterans. This is needed now because many of the veterans are having claims denied for many of these illnesses, even though research has shown a higher rate of Persian Gulf veterans having these types of illnesses versus non-Persian Gulf War veterans. We need to help change, we need your help to change Title 38 so that we can take care of those who fought for our country. With most everyone looking at what is causing Gulf War illness, it seems they are overlooking the high rates of illnesses that veterans are diagnosed with and how getting them treatment and how getting them treatment for them will make their lives a lot better. Table 3 of the Kansas study, as well as other studies, showed some of the illnesses and the rates that they occur within Gulf War veterans over non-Gulf War veterans. There needs to be a closer look at birth defects within children of the Gulf War veterans, more so looking at just female veterans versus non-veterans of females. Okay. The studies conducted both inside and outside of the VA and DOD have shown a higher number of birth defects in children of Gulf War veterans. Further research should be conducted into the types and severities of these defects with attention given to the incidences of neurological, behavioral, difficulties, as well as just the physical abnormalities. I am sure that the executive director of the Association of Birth Defects would be able to cover this area more than I would. Track down disease groupings within the Gulf War veterans. One example of this would be multiple sclerosis, since over 400 Gulf War veterans have gone to the VA to get help with MS. Many of the recognized illnesses found in the civilian population, such as MS, have higher incidences within a veteran's population. DOD and VA should be working with the civilian entities of these types of agencies who receive civilian diagnosis for conditions due to the fact that many veterans do not use the VA or DOD healthcare system. And at that time, tracking these veterans would be, at the current time, the only health tracking of these veterans would be through the VA and DOD. So the number of veterans affected with MS is grossly underestimated. One way to ensure all affected veterans are counted would be to correlate Social Security numbers of the veterans with applications for Social Security disability applications for different types of diseases.
Can you just wrap up here?
Okay. The last two information here is based further research on proposed model of phase two of the Kansas study, which was gone into great details within my written statement to you. And the third one is to have the DOD and the VA to give out better information on the exposures to nerve gas and sarin and that. So in conclusion, I'd like to say is that the only way we're going to get good research in that is to take it away from the DOD and the VA and let people like the state of Kansas do the research.
Thank you very much. As you know, your full statement will be part of the record, and it was a well-written statement. Thank you. Dr. Hall.
Thank you. I shall keep this as brief as possible. You have my full statement. I shall merely draw attention to some salient points. I was fully vaccinated and immunized, but not deployed. And current feeling in UK veterans is that we have a hidden reservoir of non-deployed sick, people who have been vaccinated unwisely, but have developed illness, and because they haven't been deployed, have failed to associate the onset of that illness with the vaccinations that they were given. My personal illnesses have been purely physical, being a cascade of one set of organ failures after another, and I'm currently awaiting now chemotherapy to try and arrest the decline in my health. As of March 7th this year, I went to the annual general meeting of our NGFA in Blackpool. There were 92 people with identical physical histories to me, the same physical symptoms in the same chronological order and in the same time frame, none of whom had been deployed. That surely speaks out very loudly that there was something wrong with the vaccination schedule. My own feeling is that it was probably the combination of pertussis with anthrax that was the root of the problem, the pertussis being the major problem. There was no clinical need for this to be given whatsoever. It was given merely to speed up the immune acceleration because of the lack of perceived notice to get troops ready for deployment. The pertussis that was given, to my knowledge, was strictly forbidden to be given to adults, yet it was administered nonetheless. In terms of the questions asked, how is treatment coming along? In Britain, the answer is very badly. There's no specific magic bullet has been found. Nothing is obvious, and we're still looking into that. In response to the question, what have we learned in Britain, I fear the answer is nothing. It would seem that the lessons we should have learned from GW1 have not been learned, and the same mistakes have been made in GW2. There are now individuals reporting the same illnesses now as were being reported in 1991. What can we do for the future? I come with a message which is sincere and from the heart, and it's quite simple to say that we don't appear to be able to fight the battle on our own, and our earnest request is that we would wish our American colleagues to continue to give us their admirable support in trying to find an answer to this terrible affliction. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hall. Dr. Heinrich.
Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee, I am pleased to be here today as you consider the current status of the federal government's research into the health concerns of Gulf War veterans. My remarks will summarize findings on the status of research on the Gulf War illnesses based on the report we are issuing today at your request. Following the Persian Gulf War in 1991, approximately 80,000 veterans have reported various symptoms such as fatigue, muscle and joint pains, rashes, headaches, memory loss. Scientists have agreed that many veterans have unexplained illnesses referred to as Gulf War illnesses that do not conform to a standard diagnosis. Possible exposures to several known and potential health hazards have prompted numerous federal research projects funded by Veterans Administration, Department of Defense, and Health and Human Services to examine possible causes for these symptoms as well as potential treatments. VA is the lead agency for all federal efforts and activities on the health consequences of service in the Gulf War. Federal research efforts have been guided by a set of 21 research questions that cover the extent of various health problems, exposures among the veteran population, and the differences in health problems between Gulf War veterans and control populations. Developed by an interagency research working group, the questions cover a range of issues such as altered immune function and neurological deficits, or possible exposure to petroleum combustion products or other agents such as insecticides.
Since 1991, 240 federal-funded projects have been initiated to address these health concerns. These projects covered several different focus areas, such as brain and nervous system research, and used a variety of methodologies. From 1994 to 2003, the total dollars expended were about $247 million. Between fiscal year 2000 and 2003, overall funding for Gulf War illnesses research has decreased by about $20 million. This overall decrease in funding was paralleled by a shift in VA's and DOD's research priorities, which expanded to include all hazardous deployments. For example, in 2002, the VA issued a program announcement for research on the long-term health effects in veterans who served in the Gulf War or in any hazardous deployments such as Afghanistan and Kosovo. Although about 80% of the projects are now complete, VA has not reassessed the extent to which the collective findings of completed Gulf War illnesses research have addressed the 21 questions that I noted before. The only assessment was published in 2001 when only about half of the studies were completed. This assessment was somewhat limited in that it did not identify gaps or promising areas for future studies. Without such an assessment, many underlying questions about cause, course of development, and treatments remain unanswered. In 2002, VA established the congressionally mandated Research Advisory Committee to provide advice to the Secretary of the VA on proposed research relating to the health consequences of military service in the Gulf War. This advisory committee is charged with assisting VA in research planning by exploring the entire body of Gulf War illness research, identifying gaps, and identifying potential areas for future study. According to the advisory committee officials, VA's poor information sharing and limited collaboration with the committee about research initiatives has made it difficult for the committee to fulfill its mission. VA recently has stated that they will be involving the advisory committee members in developing VA program announcements. In the report being issued today, we also describe the few studies that have been funded to examine the cancer incidents occurring in Gulf War veterans. Thus far, no unusual patterns have been detected, but it is too early to be definitive about cancer incidents in this population. We are also making several recommendations which the Secretary of the VA concurs with, that being the Secretary of the Veterans Affairs conduct a reassessment of the Gulf War illness research strategy, to determine whether the 21 research questions have been answered, whether they're relevant, and whether there are promising areas for future study. That a liaison who is knowledgeable about Gulf War illnesses research is appointed to routinely share information with the advisory committee and ensure that VA's research offices collaborate with the advisory committee. Mr. Chairman, that completes my prepared statement.
Thank you very much, Dr. Heinrich. Dr. Rhodes, and I just would point out that this is unusual to have two folks from GAO in the same panel, but you both have different perspectives that impact this story a little differently, and that's why we felt it was necessary to have both of you here. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee, my Lord Morris, I am pleased to participate in this international hearing by presenting our assessment of the plume modeling conducted by the Department of Defense and the Central Intelligence Agency to determine the number of U.S. troops that might have been exposed to the release of chemical warfare agents during the Gulf War in 1990. I presented our preliminary results to you in a testimony on June 6, 2003. My statement today is based on our final report entitled Gulf War Illnesses. DOD's conclusions about U.S. troop exposure are unsupported, which is being issued today. In summary, DOD and the United Kingdom's Ministry of Defense's conclusions based on DOD's plume modeling efforts regarding the extent of U.S. and British troops' exposures to chemical warfare agents cannot be adequately supported. Given the inherent weaknesses associated with the specific models DOD used and the lack of accurate
and appropriate meteorological and source term data in support of DOD's analyses, we found five major reasons to question DOD and the UK Ministry of Defense's conclusions. First, the models were not fully developed for analyzing long-range dispersion of chemical warfare agents as an environmental hazard. Second, assumptions regarding source term data used in the modeling, such as the quantity and purity of the agent, were inaccurate since they were based on uncertain and incomplete information and data that were not validated. Third, the plume heights from the Gulf War bombings were underestimated in DOD models. Fourth, post-war field testing at the U.S. Army Dugway Proving Ground to estimate the source term data did not reliably simulate the actual conditions of either the bombings or the demolition at Camisea. Fifth, there is a wide divergence in results among the individual models DOD selected, as well as in the unselected DOD and non-DOD models, with regard to the size and path of the plume and the extent to which troops were exposed. Given these inherent weaknesses, DOD and MOD cannot know which troops were and which troops were not exposed. You had asked about the total costs for the various plume modeling efforts. Total costs of the various plume modeling efforts to analyze the potential exposure of U.S. troops from the demolition at Camisea and the bombing of several other sites in Iraq cannot be estimated. DOD organizations and other entities involved with the plume modeling efforts could provide only direct cost, that is, contractor costs, which totaled about $13.7 million. However, this amount does not include an estimate of the considerable indirect costs associated with the salaries of DOD, VA, and contractor staff, or costs of facilities, travel, and equipment. We requested, but DOD could not provide this estimate. In addition, the CIA would not provide direct and indirect costs for Gulf War plume modeling because, in its view, our request constituted oversight of an intelligence matter beyond the scope of GAO authority. The CIA's contractor, the Science Applications International Corporation, also did not respond to our request for cost data. DOD's and VA conclusions that there is no association between exposure to chemical warfare agents from demolitions at Camisea and rates of hospitalization and mortality among U.S. troops also cannot be adequately supported. DOD and VA based these conclusions on two government-funded epidemiological studies, one conducted by DOD researchers, the other by VA researchers. In each of these studies, flawed criteria were used to determine which troops were exposed. These flaws may have resulted in large-scale misclassification of the exposure groups. That is, a number of exposed veterans may have been classified as non-exposed, and a number of non-exposed veterans may have been misclassified as exposed. In addition, in the hospitalization study, the outcome measure, number of hospitalizations, would not capture the chronic illnesses that Gulf War veterans commonly report, but which typically do not lead to hospitalization. Several published scientific studies of exposure involving Gulf War suggest an association between low-level exposure to chemical warfare agents and chronic illnesses. In our report, we are recommending that the Secretary of Defense and the Secretary of Veterans Affairs not use the plume modeling data for future epidemiological studies of the 1991 Gulf War, since VA and DOD cannot know from the flawed plume modeling who was and who was not exposed. We are also recommending that the Secretary of Defense require no further plume modeling of Camisea and the other sites bombed during the 1991 Gulf War in order to determine troops' exposure. Given the uncertainties in the source term and meteorological data, additional modeling of the various sites bombed would most likely result in additional costs, while still not providing any definitive data on who was and was not exposed. That concludes my summary. I'm willing to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Dr. Rhodes. Before I recognize you, Mr. Binns, I just want to make a comment, Dr. Rhodes. Your testimony is bringing up a real sore to this committee, because when we had talked about our troops being exposed to chemical weapons, and our concern about that, DOD, CIA, everyone said,
basically our troops were not exposed, but they then started to insert the word no offensive use of chemical weapons exposed in our troops. And that word offensive use was something that just kind of got inserted. In the meantime, we had a witness who had a video of Camisea and blowing up these shells and other munitions that were in Camisea. He was to testify the next week on a Tuesday. At 12 o'clock on Friday, the DOD said they would have an important announcement at 4 o'clock on Friday. At 4 o'clock on Friday, they acknowledged that our troops had been exposed to chemical weapons, which they said was defensive. And defensive meant that we had, in essence, blown up this and were dealing with this plume. So that when we then had our hearing on Tuesday, the press treated this as old news. This was stunning news, because DOD was trying to keep from the world community and from this committee and others the fact that our troops had been exposed, and they simply inserted the word offensive use of chemicals. To think now that the CIA would not cooperate with you and the work that you do as a government organization just blows me away. To think that they would care so little about our troops who serve there, that they would not have cooperated so that your study could have been more valid. Bottom line is, you have determined that the plume study is totally and completely irrelevant. And I'll just add to that, that after they announced that press conference, they said only a few of our troops, a few hundred, were exposed. Then they moved it up to 1,000. Then they moved it up to 10,000. And sitting directly behind you, Dr. Rose, is Jim Toot, who 5 years ago said this study and what's happened is just simply a joke. And you're documenting it in a study that, frankly, we wish you didn't have to have done. But I'm sorry to interrupt this hearing to just express my feelings about the outrageous cooperation we've had from the military as it relates to this issue. And there has to be an answer to this. Mr. Binns.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Lord Morris, as chairman of the Research Advisory Committee on Gulf War Veterans Illnesses, I'm honored to appear before this body. It was your committee's report which led Congress to create the Research Advisory Committee. The committee produced an interim report presenting its initial findings and recommendations in June 2002 after only one meeting. A comprehensive report reflecting our work over the first 2 years is currently undergoing final revision and will be released in approximately 6 weeks. In my time here today, I will not attempt to anticipate the full scope of that report, but let me offer an overview. First, I regret to advise you that Gulf War veterans are still ill in large numbers. Epidemiologic studies consistently show that 26% to 32% of Gulf veterans suffer from a pattern of symptoms, including fatigue, muscle and joint pains, headache, cognitive and gastrointestinal problems, over and above their counterparts who did not deploy to the Gulf. 26% to 32% translates into between 180,000 and 220,000 of the 698,000 troops who served. These ill veterans are not getting better. The most seriously ill include those with diagnosed neurological and neurodegenerative disease. So this problem remains with us. It is severe, and no treatments have been shown to be effective to any substantial degree. On the positive side, there has been a flood of new research in the last 2 years that has finally begun to shed light on the nature of this illness. By pursuing these new discoveries, medical science has the opportunity to explain the biological mechanisms at work in Gulf War illnesses and ultimately to identify treatments to address them. To illustrate the kind of progress that is taking place, let me summarize three areas where recent research has changed previous scientific thinking. First, earlier government reports have concluded that psychological stress is the likely cause of Gulf War illnesses. New studies, however, have shown that stress does not begin to explain the poor health of Gulf veterans. For example, a large 2002 study of British veterans, sponsored by the U.S. Department of Defense, concluded that more than three-quarters of ill Gulf veterans have no stress or other psychiatric disorder whatsoever. The study further concluded that, quote, post-traumatic stress disorder is not higher in Gulf veterans than in other veterans. Alternative explanations for persistent ill health in Gulf veterans are needed, end of quote. A second scientific breakthrough is reflected in new studies showing objective evidence of neurological abnormalities in ill veterans. For example, research at the Department of Veterans Affairs Medical Center in Boston has shown that ill veterans perform worse on tests of attention, visuospatial skills, and visual memory. A Department of Defense-sponsored study at the Midwest Research Institute has demonstrated that ill veterans show abnormalities on a wide range of tests of autonomic nervous system function. Third, until recently it was believed that exposure to very low levels of nerve gas, below the levels that produce symptoms at the time of exposure, did not produce any long-term effects. Within the past 2 years, however, there have been at least 9 animal studies demonstrating long-term effects on DNA, behavior, immune function, memory, and responses involving the autonomic nervous system. This research and more will be discussed in detail in the committee's upcoming report, but you can readily see that scientific progress is being made. These are government-sponsored studies conducted by a wide range of respected laboratories. With due respect to my co-committee member, it's not just Robert Haley anymore. The key question now is what research is being done to follow up on these new discoveries. Let me first address research at the Department of Veterans Affairs. VA has many talented individual researchers. VA also has strong leadership in Secretary Anthony Principi, who has personally championed this issue. In October 2002, at his direction, VA's Office of Research and Development announced a special initiative to invest up to $20 million in fiscal 2004 in deployment health research, particularly Gulf War illnesses. The Research Advisory Committee and veterans were extremely heartened by this action. However, at the committee's most recent meeting in February, the Office of Research and Development reported that with fiscal 2004 nearly half over, only one study totaling $450,000 had been funded. As you can imagine, the committee was extremely disappointed. The Secretary was equally, if not more, disappointed, and communicated forcefully to the Office of Research and Development that priority be given to this area. Since then, I have seen a dramatic turnaround in the outlook of the Office of Research and Development toward Gulf War veterans' illnesses. A new program will be announced in the near future. It will include new research initiatives specifically dedicated to Gulf War illnesses. Equally important, it will reflect a purposeful, logical approach to direct Gulf War illnesses research toward the areas of greatest scientific opportunity and the development of treatments.
Mr. Binns, I'm going to ask you to, and we don't usually do this, we're going to just ask you to wrap up.
Okay.
Your statement is excellent and it's there for us, but...
Let me just make one point, and that is that the vast majority of the funding for the Department for Gulf War Illnesses research over the years has come from the Department of Veterans, not from the Department of Veterans Affairs, but from the Department of Defense. So that even with this new research initiative that I speak of, there will still be a dramatic overall decline in Gulf War Illnesses research compared to historical levels. Between 1999 and 2002, the average government research for Gulf War Illnesses was approximately $35 million in direct research. This year, the Department of Defense is spending in new research, that is, new initiatives funded to follow up on these breakthrough studies, no additional money. The Department of Veterans Affairs may spend up to $11 million. So you have a decline from $35 million to approximately $11 million at a time when the research is finally beginning to show breakthroughs. In addition, the effect of these decisions extends far beyond ill Gulf War veterans. The new research emerging from the study of Gulf War veterans' illnesses has important implications to the war on terrorism. Terrorist alerts at home and military actions abroad provide constant reminders of the risk of chemical attack. It is indeed tragic that at this hour of need, just as the investment in past research is finally beginning to pay off and point the way toward success, there are not funds to pursue these discoveries. It particularly perplexes the members of the committee that funding for programs like the U.S. Army Institute of Chemical Defense is actually being reduced at this critical moment in our history, and that research to develop medical countermeasures to chemical threats has not been included in the $1.7 billion NIH counterterrorism program. Gulf War veterans are no longer the stragglers from a forgotten war. They are the advance guard for all of us.
Thank you very much, Mr. Binns. Mr. Robinson, and then we're going to take questions. I will go first with Mr. Sanders, then I'll go to Mr. Turner, who has graciously allowed Mr. Sanders to go first, then to you, Ms. Tierney. And Lord Morris and I will figure out who goes next.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, and Lord Morris, headline from the Associated Press on May 26th, nerve agent sarin was in an Iraq bomb. And the key statement out of this document, apparently reported by the Department of Defense, no one was injured after its initial detonation, but two American soldiers who removed the round had symptoms of low-level nerve agent exposure, officials have said. A person exposed to a large dose of sarin can suffer convulsions, paralysis, loss of consciousness, and could die from respiratory failure. But in small doses, people usually recover completely. Mr. Chairman, as you know, this battle for veterans' recognition of Gulf War illness has spanned over 14 years. And you also know that it was initially fought in the court of public opinion as to whether or not veterans were ill because of stress or there was some real factor involved. Today we can report that science is unraveling the mysteries of Gulf War illness and that there is a political will to look for answers. Nothing that happened to Gulf War veterans in 1991 should be a mystery to anyone in this room because of science that has been produced today. However, there are still researchers in DOD and in the VA healthcare system that refuse to read, recite, promote, or look at the new science or new committees formed to address this issue. This continued effort by a few bad people who hold key positions is the reason we are just now looking into treatment modalities for Gulf War veterans. Mr. Chairman, I believe you will agree that we need a Manhattan-like project assessment of what has happened, where we're going, and what we need to do for the future. Because I know that you believe, as I do, that this risk of exposure to chemical warfare agents can happen here in the United States, in your home, in your town, where even low levels may be presented and no one would ever know it. It's very important for us to understand what has happened to ill Gulf War veterans. It's not enough to hold hearings on the issue to expose the flaws in the system. The time has come for accountability and focused determination. Where needed, Congress must pass laws mandating research and treatment. When discovered, Congress must punish those who deliberately lean away from the veteran or those who purposely manipulate and inhibit science based on old theories that have long since found untrue. Right now, there's a Gulf War veteran in the United Kingdom who is on a hunger strike, and chances are he'll die if he goes through with his hunger strike. And what he's asking for is public hearings. And we hope that this committee's work, our testimony today, and what Lord Morris takes back will encourage the MOD to hold those public hearings so that the Gulf War veterans will have the same benefit that we have had for much of the research that's here in the U.S. What do we know about today? For all intents and purposes, the DOD is not conducting research or investigating things related to Gulf War illnesses. There is still this belief with some that stress is the reason why veterans are sick. Recently, soldiers who returned from Iraq have had their medical concerns classified as in-your-head hysteria when they ask for screening for dangerous substances like depleted uranium, larium, or exposure to sarin. In all the cases above, the department downplayed the exposures and even in the face of scientific data, ignored some of the exposures. Now, I just recently learned outside in the hall that apparently the department is going to produce some document or some evidence that says they took blood from some of these soldiers exposed to sarin, and they may in fact be tracking them. But we don't know that, and we'd like for them to be public about it. And certainly our interest has peaked, hoping that they did learn the lessons of 1991. These soldiers also who have had a chemical weapons exposure should be eligible for a Purple Heart. A chemical weapons exposure at the hands of the enemy is no different than an IED attack or an ambush, and it's something that we need to look at. The single most egregious thing that has happened in terms of DOD research is the lack of population identification. The DOD is not providing researchers, the VA, or the soldiers unique information identifying where they served or what they may have been exposed to. And simply stating that a soldier served in Southwest Asia is not the kind of data the IOM or the VA will need to conduct epidemiological studies. Now, one of the things that, and I've got 15 seconds left, one of the things that is most important in getting doctors to do the right thing by Gulf War veterans is that the VA and the DOD has to look at and promote the new science. These are three books that the VA puts out. One's called Caring for the War Wounded, one's called Health Effects from Chemical and Biological and Radiological, and this one is the guide for Gulf War veterans. These are the Veterans Health Initiative. Clinicians in the VA are supposed to read this to understand what are the exposures of Gulf War veterans. There's nothing in this document that reflects the science that we know today. This is all information from 1999 and back. It's the stress theory, and it needs to be updated, because if the clinicians in the VA don't know what the illnesses are, they don't know what the exposures are, they can't possibly come up with treatments or give the veterans the kind of care they need. I would encourage the committee to please ask the VA to update this, and I submit the rest of my statement for the record.
Thank you very much, Mr. Robinson, and thanks to all the panelists. And we'll start with Mr. Sanders. We're going to do 10-minute questioning so we can get in a little more depth here. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chris Shays and I have participated in dozens and dozens of hours of hearings, and I have to say that this is the most peculiar process that I've ever seen in my life. Something is wrong here. We have evidence that over 26% of Gulf War vets were made casualties. That's probably the largest number in any war on history. Dr. Hall tells us that he recently went to a meeting and that over 92 people were present who had identical physical symptoms. I have talked to Gulf War veterans in the state of Vermont around the room where they tell me when they walk into a grocery store and they smell detergents or perfume, they get sick. We have heard, Chris and I have heard people come forward here with terrible, terrible illnesses. That's one reality that Chris Shays and I and other members of this committee have heard for years. And then there's another reality that seems to come from the officials is, we have heard today from Dr. Heindrich that A, they have 80,000 soldiers have reported symptoms, significantly less than the number that Mr. Binns made. But number two, we have 241 federally funded projects spending $247 million. Dr. Heindrich, is there a Gulf War illness?
The experts that we spoke with, sir, have said that there is unusual symptoms and that they still cannot identify the cause. But it's also clear to us that they are doing studies to try to further identify what that might be.
Thank you. That's it. And that's the insanity that we're dealing with. $247 million, and your researchers have come up with the fact that there are symptoms. Hey, you could have saved a lot of money. Chris Shays and I knew that there were symptoms. Mr. Bunk, are there symptoms?
Yes.
Mr. Robinson, are there symptoms?
Absolutely.
Good. We don't have to pay them $247 million. So what are we doing? I have concluded, and I don't mean this to be a mean statement to the members of the DOD, because I know in their hearts they certainly want all veterans to get a fair shake and to be well. But something very strange is going on. I do not know why, from day one, the DOD, to a lesser degree the VA, but both institutions have been resistant to the very serious crisis that we are facing and the pain that is going on. And I would agree, for a start, with Mr. Bunk, who made a very simple statement, and he said, we should get the research money out of the VA and the DOD. I think that's right. Now, let me ask
Again, Dr. Heinrich, a very simple question. I want to get to Mr. Binns. Dr. Haley, who is a researcher who's be testifying later on, this is what he says in his report that he's going to tell us later. He says, quote, I am encouraged at the progress that has been made in understanding the new type of brain cell damage that appears to underlie Gulf War veterans' symptoms, end of quote. Is he crazy? Now, he's been saying this for years. What do you say? And he hasn't spent $243 million. Is he right? Is he wrong?
He's right.
What we have seen and what experts have said to us is that there are concerns that there is neurological damage, and I think that that's one reason you'll hear the VA talk about new efforts to fund studies that are really focusing on neurodegeneration.
But he has gone beyond concerns that there may be neurological damage. He has gone a lot further than that, and it is incredible to me and to the taxpayers of this country and to all of the people who are concerned about our veterans that the VA and the DOD have done so very little. Mr. Binns, I want to thank you. I mean, I know I'm not a great fan of President Bush, let me tell you that. But I think that in appointing you and Anthony Principi, we have some serious people who are trying to deal with this issue. From your point of view, give us some understanding of why the government has been so lax in coming up with an understanding of the cause or some kind of treatment, despite the not insignificant sum of money. Where do you think we should be going from here?
Is it on?
Yep.
Here. I can't answer the question of why they haven't gotten with the program.
How would you assess $243 million being spent with the results that we've seen?
The program has been, a lot of the money has been spent in areas which, at least today, we can conclude, and earlier you might have been prepared to conclude, were not the areas that would lead to the most promising answers. For example, as recently as 2003, the VA budget in that year, according to the recent report to Congress, provided for about $4.1 million in Gulf War illnesses research. Of that amount, 57% went to study stress and other psychological causes. 17% went to study things like web-based training for VA physicians on bioterrorism events. So only 17% actually went for things that we believe are directly related.
We don't have a lot of time. See, look, see, I don't mean to be rude.
Okay.
Based on all of the evidence, do you agree or disagree with Mr. Bunker, who basically is saying, look, we need research. These guys are not going to do it. We should get it out of the VA and the DOD.
I would have agreed with you 4 months ago, but Secretary Principi, as I'm sure the representatives here from VA will attest, is very concerned about this issue. I wish I could guarantee that Secretary Principi would be the Secretary of Veterans Affairs for the next 20 years or so. We are going to have a good program that is very accelerated coming out of VA. Whether it can continue and whether there is a sustained effort depends upon many factors, as you well know. So I think if you want to guarantee that there will be this kind of effort, both from VA and DOD, Congress would need to make it a line item budget that there be Gulf War illnesses research.
But you see, you can appreciate the frustration that we feel. $243 million is not an insignificant sum of money.
Yeah.
And the question is, you heard from Dr. Heinrich, basically they've done very little with this money. So I think the question is not that there should not be money, but should we be saying, look, for whatever reason, the DOD is certainly not going to do it. Maybe the VA will do something, but we've got to get out of Capitol Hill and start finding serious researchers in the private sector, who, by the way, if I'm not mistaken, I don't mean to be personal here, but I think you came into this issue out of family issues because you saw a correlation between a family member and the illness that our veterans were seeing. Is that correct?
Yes, and I think that you're right in saying that there needs to be a mix, I believe, of VA and outside research. The limitation of VA research is that they can only fund VA physicians. Obviously, that is where the veterans are, so there should be a substantial investment there. And as I said, I believe they're about to do that. On the other hand, you need to have, I don't know who is the one to do it, NIH or DOD,
but you need to have some agency with the capability of funding the best talent available outside of the federal government. And you need to have a total funding commitment that is at least the level of the historical levels of commitment. Because this time, I'm naive perhaps, but I believe that at least it's happening at VA, and I think I see it happening in other agencies as well. I don't believe it will be wasted.
In your judgment, is Dr. Haley making some important breakthroughs?
Dr. Haley has been the guy out there with the spear advancing on this evil for many, many years. He's made continued advances. Today, I would say he's got squads of troops behind him, and he's got other people in the woods that you'll be hearing from later on who really represent the heavy artillery that are willing to come into this data area.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, how am I doing on time?
You got another minute and a half.
Okay. Let me say, I mean, there's some good news, is that some breakthroughs are being made. Unfortunately, they have not been made within the DOD. And largely, and by the way, I have a lot of affection and respect for Anthony Principi as well, and I know his heart is in the right place on this. But I think we owe it to our veterans not just to throw money out there, but to target that money to serious people within the VA, within the private sector, and some of our universities who are prepared to work with non-government researchers to begin to advance some of the ideas that are beginning to be developed. Dr. Hall, let me just get back to you. What I heard you say is that not a whole lot more is happening in the UK. Is that your perception?
That's correct, sir. I think we face the same sort of problems in that the money that's being spent is being utilized by people who you may describe as being in the employ of central government. They are simply government lackeys who produce what the government wish to hear. There seems to be no independent research going on, or if there is, it isn't breaking through the press barrier to get free publication.
Repeat, the chairman has asked me, when you mentioned 92 people with identical physical symptoms at a meeting, how many people were at the meeting?
200. I wrote down...
Is that in your...
Approximately 50,000... people deployed, of which 5,000 have reported symptoms, 1,500 are members of the NGVFA, 200 were at the AGM, and of those 200, 92 people who could take my place.
And what does your government say when you present them with this information?
I have recent correspondence from my Prime Minister decrying that this syndrome exists. And that's correct as of 2 weeks ago.
Denying? What, decrying? What was the word?
Denying that this syndrome exists. My ill health problems are officially denied.
So the government, the official position of the government of the UK is that...
My illness does not exist. It is imaginary, yet I have X-ray proof, I have MRI scans, my blood chemistry is deranged. I'm now pre-leukemic. That is not an imaginary condition.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank the gentleman. At this time, we'll go to Mr. Turner and then to Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate all of the testimony that we received today, and it is when you look at the issue of both the medical science, but also the analytical science that's being applied to determine what happened in the field of battle. I'm fascinated with the discussion on plume modeling, as I said in my opening statement, because you know, on this subcommittee, so many times we have heard from people who have testified with seemingly absolute certainty as to what would occur under certain circumstances with respect to a plume. Utilizing the technology for planning purposes, not only as a guide for what we need to respond to, but of what we don't need to respond to, and that concerns me greatly, because it seems as if the science is not yet defined enough for us to exclude outcomes. And in looking at GAO's report and the DOD, stated DOD's conclusions about U.S. troop exposure cannot be adequately supported. When we talk about the amount of money that's been spent, I note in the testimony it says the direct costs alone were $13.7 million for plume modeling, and that does not include indirect costs of in-house work that was done. So $13.7 million was spent outside for the purposes of plume modeling. And then the conclusion is that from the GAO is that they are recommending that Secretary of Defense and the Secretary of Veterans Affairs not use the plume modeling data for future epidemiological studies of the 1991 Gulf War, since VA and DOD cannot know from the flawed plume modeling who was and who was not exposed. Again, getting the issue of not just what may have happened, but trying to say what didn't happen. And then you go on to talk about the unreliable assumptions that make up the plume modeling that make it useless. The issue of the nature of the pit demolition, meteorology, agent purity, amount of agent released, and other chemical warfare agent data, all of which when we try to prospectively guess about what might happen under circumstances of a terrorist attack or terrorist incident, are variables that will not be known and seem to me at times to be almost unlimited. I'd like to hear from you, Dr. Rhodes, and others who might want to comment. You're recommending that plume modeling not continue to be pursued because this data is not accurate enough. Is it possible to undertake plume modeling of this? It seems as if you're saying both the data that they currently have is not reliable, the monies that have been invested do not give the adequate return, but also it raises the question is, you know, can it even be done?
Mr. Turner, you have asked the right question. Can it even be done? The answer is it can be done if you understand exactly what you want to do with the outcome. If you are trying to plan the evacuation of a city, if you are trying to plan whether or not people should seal themselves up in place, that can be done assuming you have enough data. The meteorological data is missing from Iraq because Iraq stopped delivering meteorological data to the World Met Organization in 1981. If I am trying to get to a number, 101,752 troops were exposed, modeling cannot, I repeat, cannot give you that number. That number is an impossible number to get. It can give you a first-order approximation. It cannot give you a number as precise as that, which is what is being parlayed at the moment. It's being proffered as this is the number. That number is incorrect. The data that were loaded into the models can give you diverging plumes. And the best that we can conclude from looking at the modeling is that 700,000 soldiers, including people in Kuwait, including civilian populations in Saudi Arabia, may have been exposed. Now, from a policy perspective, that's the best that we can proffer to you based on the modeling. But we can't give you, I cannot sit here and say that the number 101,752 is correct, and none of the data show it. That doesn't mean don't model in other scenarios, the ones that you're talking about, an evacuation scenario, or should we shelter in place or something like that. That can be done. But it has to be done with the understanding that all models are first order approximations. They are not going to give you reality. They are going to give you a snapshot of reality. For example, as you see in our testimony, as you pointed out, you know, the configuration of the munition and how it was detonated varies on the plume height. How high did it go? As you see in our report, there was an arbitrary number established, and that was exactly how DOD described it. It was the arbitrary value of 10 meters. When a 2,000-pound bomb can give you upwards of a 400-meter plume. At 400 meters, that plume is going to start to shelf, and it'll spread out, where you get the classic mushrooming design. Can I tell you at this point in time exactly how it mushroomed? Can I tell you at this point in time exactly who was under it? No. But I can tell you that anyone who was in theater at the time of the demolitions or the bombings may have been exposed. But I can't tell you that it's you and not I, or that it's myself and not you. And that's the problem with what's being done with the model, is that it's being asked for a degree of precision that it cannot give. And therefore, what we get is the wrong answer faster to a greater degree of precision. And that's why we say in this instance, not in all models, but in this incident, in this instance, and for these purposes, don't waste your money.
I do have a follow-up question. Does anyone else want to comment on the issue of the plume modeling? It seems to have done a great job on that. Mr. Robinson.
I believe in some cases, once the information was produced, which we now clearly believe is a flawed model, that that data was used for years and years by both DOD and VA researchers to make other conclusions that they themselves were also flawed. And I think it's important that if an event like this does occur again in the future, the key number one thing we need, besides retrospective modeling, is what happens when the event occurs, which is identify the people who were exposed, mark it down in their medical records, point them towards follow-up treatment and care, and when they come back, make sure that they receive that care, and then do a long-term follow-up. If that had been done after the 1991 Gulf War, those basic steps, identify who potentially was exposed, tell them what the risks were, put it in their medical records, and then point them towards people who understand that kind of exposure, we might not be sitting here today. We'd know a lot more if we had taken that. And the last thing is, besides modeling, listen to what the soldiers say. The soldiers reported this early on, that there was a problem. So if something happens in this war, listen to what the soldiers say. Make sure their information is documented.
One of the things that Mr. Rhodes said that I find interesting is that, you know, obviously British troops, U.S. troops, others, they were not the only ones in theater. There were Iraqis, there were Kuwaitis, and you indicated that they might have had similar exposure. What information do we have, what reports do we have of similar types of symptoms occurring in the populations that were in Iraq or Kuwait?
Let me try to answer that. We don't have a lot of information about the populations that are in that part of the world, and there are studies that are being funded now that are trying to identify, for example, the health of soldiers in Saudi Arabia and other Middle East states.
What about the populations, though? That, I mean, we've been in Iraq now a year. You know, obviously, we have a strong relationship with Kuwait. You know, what are we hearing? What do we know about the types of expression of these symptoms that they have in their population? Anything at all?
The government of Kuwait is, in fact, studying its National Guard soldiers. It doesn't make the U.S. news. There are researchers from the United States, from different universities that are in not only Kuwait, but in Saudi Arabia and in Iraq right now as we speak, looking to form the baselines for epidemiological studies. It just doesn't make the U.S. news.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, gentlemen. This time the Chair would recognize Mr. Tierney for 10 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you again for continuing on with this series of hearings. I have a number of folks in my district who expressed an interest in this, not the least of which is recently a letter from one of my constituents explaining that his 62-year-old cousin had died, a fellow that grew up in my town, went to school in the school that I graduated from, enlisted in the U.S. Marine Corps in 1959. His career spanned 42 years, two wars, Vietnam and Operation Desert Storm, 29 years of active and reserve service. He was acknowledged as one of the longest-serving intelligence officers in the history of the Marine Corps, and he served as an enlisted intelligence specialist. And he died after a long illness on that, which one of the reasons we're having these hearings to find out just what that could be. He served in Kuwait. Have there been any studies, not any information that we have, that would distinguish the types of symptoms being experienced by individuals in different parts of that operation? Sir?
The Kansas study showed that according to where a person was stationed at, it made a difference as to the types of symptoms and that they had. That was a study done by Dr. Leah Steele, and it was published in November of 2002.
And what are we doing as a result of that? Is some of our research, Mr. Benz, focusing on that?
The specific finding was that 41% of the veterans in that Kansas study who were in the forward area, who actually entered Kuwait or Iraq, fell into the ill population over and above the control group. One of our recommendations as a committee is going to be that future studies always look at the locations and at the unit designations of ill veterans, because based on that limited information, there does appear to be a dramatic difference in where the troops were compared to how sick they are.
And Mr. Benz, in your work so far, I noticed that Mr. Robbins made the point of listening to the veterans, listening to the people that were there. Do you find that most of the studies are now doing that? Has there been a change from the early reports that distinctly indicated that they thought there was an inadequate regard for what the veteran participants were saying?
No, I think this is mostly an idea that we're just initiating now. It has not been applied in the past.
So it continues to be an issue until now. Right. Mr. Sanders, you have other questions to ask too, and I don't want to cut you out because I know you've been working on this for a long time. Feel free to jump in on that if you do. With that is a continuing problem. One of the other earlier findings was that there was that there would needed to be a better management of the research portfolio. What progress have we made on that, Mr. Benz, Mr. Robinson? Please.
As I said, within the past, it's just 3 months. We, at the Secretary's direction and the leadership of the Office of Research and Development at VA, have been working much more closely together than we ever did before on developing a research program that indeed is focused on certain key questions which our research, our reading of research shows are the questions that need to be answered, and is not focused on topics which, while they are perfectly legitimate topics for VA research, stress, are not relevant to this topic. So we believe that we're making progress. Hopefully this program will be announced in the near future by VA, and that will be the start, I would say again, of moving to an organized, comprehensive research plan. There has been a mechanism for coordination between VA and DOD in the past. It does not appear to have been a coordinated effort. It was more of a shotgun effort.
Mr. Tierney, if I could jump in. Let me ask a simple question. We are looking at what I have heard is about 125,000 out of 700,000 who came home with one or another type symptom. That's a huge number, probably more than in any war in our history. Simple question. Let me start with you, Mr. Benz. You mentioned that, and maybe Mr. Bunker or Mr. Robinson might want to jump in. Are these people getting better over time? Are they getting worse? Does anybody bother to find out?
They do not appear to be getting better. Some of them are getting worse.
In the Kansas study, there was a small number that appeared they may be getting a little bit better. I can be an example for you, too, is if you have known me 4 years ago, you wouldn't recognize me as the same person. Mr. Toot met me about 3 or 4 years ago. I was on two crutches. This time of day, I'd be incapacitated because of my cognitive disabilities and all that.
But you have seen some improvements.
I had a neurological doctor who ran some tests to see if I was just having seizures, and I wasn't. But he did put me on a low dose of seizure medicine.
Sorry to interrupt you.
That low dose seizure medicine he put me on I have not had the cognitive dysfunction like I used to have. My productivity has greatly increased to me.
The simple question, one would think if one was serious in trying to understand and treat this illness, we would say, okay, 14 years have come and gone, this percentage are doing better, this percentage are worse, the rate of mortality is higher, it's lower, whatever. Do we know that, Mr. Benz?
No. We know mortality. There have been studies of mortality, and there have been studies of certain hospitalizations and so on. But as to, there are not comprehensive records or studies done of whether the treatments being prescribed in VA hospitals or elsewhere are effective. And that's been one of our major recommendations in this report coming out, that evidence such as what Jim is suggesting be developed. You can't go and fund a $9 million clinical trial on the basis of an anecdotal case or two. The problem has been that there has been no organized effort to take this kind of information and actively develop it. Go find the doctor, put him together with some VA doctors, and have them do a small trial, see if it works, find out why. That is a key part of this problem, because I believe there are treatments out there that work.
You reclaim my time. Who's not doing that? Who didn't do it and who is now doing it?
Nobody is doing it right now. We are recommending that VA do it.
Right. Dr. Heinrich, if we were to expand this out beyond the VA and the Department of Defense, who ought Congress to charge with being involved in this research, either in coordinating it or conducting some of it? Where would we be best directed?
Well, I can tell you that at this time there is a deployment group with a subcommittee for research that does coordinate this across DOD, VA, and HHS agencies. In terms of where would the money best be placed so that it's expended in ways such as Mr. Benz has suggested, it's a hard question for me to answer.
Who would you recommend we go to for the answer then? Because obviously most of us up here are not scientists in this area, not medical people either. So
I would suggest that you talk with the leadership at the VA and the people within the Department of Defense that have responsibility for the deployment health.
Okay, but basically go back where the problem has been.
Yes.
Is what you're telling us. I'm not sure that's a very great idea. Mr. Robinson, you want to weigh in on that?
Instead of having to make an all or nothing, let's don't let DOD or let's don't let VA do research, what we need is oversight with teeth that will honest people, ombudsmen, non-scientists, scientists, an independent group of people, much like the VA Research Advisory Committee could play that role, to be involved in the process and be an honest broker. What we've had over the last 13 years is decisions being made that weren't necessarily in the best interest of the veteran. We needed an honest broker in there to say, maybe we don't go down that road this time. My recommendation is that the VA Research Advisory Committee be given at least oversight. Maybe you don't give them the actual authority to choose, but we've got to at least have oversight into what's going on so we can tell the veterans what is or is not happening.
Mr. Benz, does your group not have that authority now? And if it doesn't, do you think that would be effectively used by your group? To what end?
My personal opinion is that the more our group is involved, the better the research program will be, and that one of the keys in the last 3 months is that we have been actively involved. We have been participating in writing the new RFA. We are going to be involved in reviewing the studies. We've been introducing key researchers to the VA, and they've been listening to us. So, yes, I think the more we're involved, the better. Let me just add that I also, coming from the private sector, believe in competition. I think that if you had a treatment development program going on at VA, that's a logical thing to do. Create another one outside of VA in some research university to do the same thing and see who gets there first.
Mr. Bunker, you wanted to say something?
Bunker? Sir, you are talking about the treatment earlier in that. I've been trying for 4 years now to get money from the federal government to do our phase two on the Kansas study, which would be looking at how veterans are getting better over time. I cannot get funding out of the VA because the VA will only fund VA projects. That's why in my testimony I said, you know, get the research away from the VA. The RAC, as it's set up right now, is an excellent oversight because they can give the funding either to a VA researcher or a private researcher or a state like the state of Kansas to do research. We have a plan there that we want to act on, but we need the money to do it. And it would be great if we could get some of the money out of the VA or from the federal government to do the next step and look at the health of the veterans and what's going to make them better.
Thank you. Mr. Sanders, anything you want to add as we close?
Mr. Benz, let me go back to you. Has there been much discussion, or are you aware of a correlation between the symptoms associated with Gulf War illness and symptoms that we see in the civilian society? Lou Gehrig's disease, I know, comes to mind.
There is certainly an overlap, which has been recognized by VA and DOD over the years, between Gulf War illnesses and conditions like fibromyalgia or chronic fatigue syndrome or multiple chemical sensitivity. Our committee has focused in its initial 2 years on the scope of Gulf War illnesses and the neurological connections and exposures which may explain neurological connections. We are about to begin focusing on treatments, and we certainly are going to be looking at the experience of both civilian and government doctors in those areas. Our next meeting is at the East Orange Veterans Administration Medical Center, where Dr. Ben Nadelson is one of the chief NIH researchers on chronic fatigue and fibromyalgia.
Would you agree that it might be a fertile field of study to see a correlation between how the civilian society and perhaps their exposures relate to people who are in the Gulf?
Completely, yes.
Okay. All right, I yield back to my friend. Thanks very much for...
Lord Morris, you have the floor.
Chairman, Dr. Hall spoke movingly. Dr. Hall spoke movingly and with unmistakable integrity and commitment. I was delighted by his plea for more US-UK cooperation. He speaks highly representatively of UK veterans. Dr. Hall referred to the pertussis vaccine used in the UK. It was produced by the French manufacturer, Merieux, and was not licensed for use in the UK. Nevertheless, 40,000 doses of the vaccine were used. Although he was not deployed to the Gulf, as Bernie Sanders noticed, Dr. Hall had the same vaccinations as people who were. He presents the same illnesses that so many other veterans of the Gulf War are presenting. Does he know of anyone else? He must have had many, many contemporaries. Does he know of anyone else who was not deployed, was not subjected to the mass multiple immunization program, but is presenting the same kind of illnesses? I don't.
No, sir, I don't. I only know a few people who are supposed or said to have GWS who were vaccinated but non-deployed. But as I said earlier, I think we have a hidden reservoir of immunized, non-deployed personnel who just do not make the critical association between their current health status and the vaccinations they were forced to undergo. And as a result of that, it never enters their mind that they may have GWS. And currently, we're in the middle of trying to complete a demographic study of all traceable veterans involved in GW1. Until we get comprehensive replies, we're not going to be in a position to make a statement about the various incidences of illness in those who were deployed as opposed to those who weren't deployed. But as I've intimated, the only person I know well who was non-deployed is currently on hunger strike. That's Alex, is it?
As he knows, I continue to press again and again for an independent inquiry. And I can tell him that what he said this afternoon, we're very much in my mind in continuing to press. Turning to Dr. Rhodes, the Ministry of Defense's original estimate was that only one British serviceman could possibly have been exposed to the fallout at Camp Isaiah. How many of the British troops does he think could potentially have been exposed? Moreover, can the MOD's reported view that the highest theoretical dosage British troops received was well below the level at which the first noticeable symptoms occur and could have had no detectable effect on health still be valid? Finally, Dr. Rhodes, how do you believe your findings will help American and British troops, researchers, and clinicians.
Thank you, Lord Morris. In answer to your first question, how many, the UK's Ministry of Defense claim that there's only one UK soldier who was exposed as a result of the Camisea demolition. Based on the conclusion made by the Ministry of Defense is based on the Department of Defense and CIA modeling. That modeling is specious at best. Therefore, that assumption made by the Ministry of Defense is also specious. It cannot be correct because it has no basis in reality. I have heard the Ministry of Defense defend their position, but knowing the modeling that was assigned, that their assumption was based on, I realized that that number cannot be valid. What is the correct number? The correct number is no one knows. I'm not trying to trivialize the point here, but that the main thrust is that all UK troops deployed in the theater of operations for the entire time that Al-Muthanna, Muhammadiyat, Al-Khaydir, Qamisiyah, when all of these sites were destroyed, could possibly be exposed. And that's the reality. That leads to your second question, the answer to your second question about percentage being below the dose at which symptoms would be expressed. That's also unknown because the assumptions about the concentration of agent inside each of these locations varied wildly. Some said that it could have been as low as zero concentration, some were 18, some were upwards of 50%. So as those numbers vary, I do not know how one mathematically derives any estimation of dosage, which leads into the answer to your last question. What can the understanding of the limitations of the models do for the Allied troops, those that were deployed? One cannot assume, based on these models and based on these efforts, that we know who was and who was not exposed. Therefore, don't force the veteran to prove that he's sick. That's how we can help, is to say, you are expressing symptoms. The symptoms can now be seen scientifically in the framework of possible exposure to low-level nerve agent. And then they aren't viewed as individual symptoms, but can be, as Mr. Benz was talking about in the data collection, they can now be viewed in more of a mosaic. They can be viewed more as, oh, these might possibly be a collection of symptoms that add up to something else. And that way, we're able to help the veterans, both UK and US. Thank you.
Mr. Benz, you have been a giant in trying to get this government and the Department of Veterans Affairs to take seriously Gulf War illnesses, and you have had impact on that. And for you now to, not now, but for you to reiterate before this committee, first, I regret to advise you that Gulf War veterans are still ill in large numbers. To say epidemiological studies consistently show that 26 to 32% of Gulf War veterans suffer from a pattern of symptoms,
including fatigue, muscle and joint pains, headaches, cognitive and gastrointestinal problems over and above their counterparts who do not deploy to the Gulf. That 26% to 32% is a casualty rate which rivals the darkest hours in American history. It translates into 180,000 to 220,000 of the 698 troops who served in the Gulf War. And then say these ill veterans are not getting better is just depressing. We have not had a hearing very recently, and I am just almost at a loss of words. Why are we losing steam? Why is it because we haven't had hearings to make this in the public's eye? Is it just, you know, old soldiers never die, they just pass away? What is it?
I think that the personnel and the attitudes of the Departments of Veterans Affairs and the Department of Defense, while they may have changed at the top and at the bottom, that is to say individual researchers and also at the secretary level, at VA at least, and DOD obviously has been busy with other things. In the middle you have had a group of people who were really the same people who were involved in running Gulf War Illnesses research when you wrote your 1997 report. And until there was convincing new science, and that has been difficult to marshal until recent years because it has been primarily private research and isolated research. But now that we have government research, and I want to give credit to the Department of Defense's research program, they are the ones who have produced most of this research that we have cited to you and that you'll be hearing from later on today. The evidence has reached a tipping point where a public official like Secretary Principe will no longer accept excuses. Before that, we were providing our information. To be fair, we have not published our report. Our report will be out in 6 weeks, and it will address all of these areas comprehensively. If we had gotten our report out a year ago, perhaps it would have influenced things to move faster. I think now is the time to move, though. There is a tipping point now, both in the science and in the reason for taking action. Both the veterans are still ill, and we have, as Congressman Turner has pointed out, a much larger issue at stake.
Okay, explain to me now the funding issue so I know where the requirement lies. We're basically starting to learn valuable information, but the funding is going down. Is that a discretionary determination on the part of VA, DOD, or Congress? I mean, tell me where the read is here.
My understanding is that none of these items are line items at the moment, and therefore it is discretionary to VA and to DOD. And at VA, we have seen that the initiative announced by the Secretary 2 years ago was not fulfilled due to a variety of factors. Now we have new initiatives coming out of VA that we believe will increase the level of funding of VA to approximately $15 million a year. But that will be dramatically below the $35 to $40 million level of 1999 to 2002 for the federal government as a whole. DOD has just gone out of the business.
And the $35 million is in general terms, a fairly small sum.
Yes, you were to set this in terms of saying, what is it going to take us to do the job within 4 years, I believe the sum would be larger.
Right. See, what I'm wrestling with, among a lot of other things. I mean, obviously I wrestle with the fact that we have 17 hearings where at first DOD came and said they're not sick, VA said they're not sick, that it's more a mental issue that impacts them physically, but it's mental stress. And then we had the sick veterans come and demonstrate they were sick through documentation and also through just visual reality. And so, you know, and at least the epidemiological studies have determined they are sick, they are not well. So we know that. I would think that there would be this huge interest to say, well, you know, we're going to be sending more people into battle and we want to learn from this, and we value the men and women who serve. And so, you know, it's not just dealing with the veterans who are sick now, it's also the veterans who may become sick who we could prevent from becoming sick. So there's every logic that says we should deal with this. With the plume studies, Dr. Rhodes, I mean, you kind of, it seems to me, unless I'm going to hear something different in the next panel, you kind of hit the ball out of the park. I mean, in a negative way, you're basically saying the plume studies are worthless. Is that not true?
Yes.
They're totally worthless.
Yes.
And we have given out money based on, and we are doing research based on, in your judgment, a worthless plume studies. Is that correct?
Correct.
Yeah. So the fact that you suggest no more be done, and the fact that DOD and CIA and others say they don't intend to, you've come to the same conclusion in one sense, you're not going to do more. But the difference is they have not yet said to you they agree with your analysis. Is that correct?
No, actually, we did collect comments. And after some clarification with the Department of Defense, they did say that the modeling of these events, because that was the bone of contention, was that it was the modeling. The Department of Defense assumed that we were striking a prohibition against all modeling. But it was, we clarified the point that we were talking about just about Qamishia, Muhammadiyat, Al-Mutana, Al-Qaidir, the 1991 modeling event, bombing event. And after clarification, they did say that they thought that the modeling would not be fruitful.
And there's no question in Qamishia that there were significant amounts of chemical weapons, correct?
Correct.
I mean, so there's no dispute about that. What's interesting, I mean, we talk about 125 millimeter rockets were identified at Bunker 7. The rockets were found to have been filled with a combination of sarin and cyroglycerin nerve agents. Several hundred and 122 millimeter rockets containing the same nerve agents were also found at a pit area close to Bunker 73. It was not until 1996 that UNSCOM conclusively determined that CW agents were in Bunker 77. And then you have in your report in September, just for review, 1996, DOD estimated that 5,000 troops had been within 25 km radius of Qamishia. In October 1996, DOD extended this radius to 50. It estimated 20,000 U.S. troops had been within this zone. In July 1997, from the first plume analysis, DOD estimated that 98,910 U.S. troops had potentially been exposed. In 2,000 additional analysis led DOD to estimate that 101,752,000 U.S. troops had potentially been exposed. Is there any question, though, that tens of thousands of troops were exposed? We just don't know who they were. Is there a doubt of hundreds of thousands? I mean, or can't we even say that?
I don't. None of the modeling efforts are going to be definitive enough to give you a number.
So what do we know? Basically, we just know that there were lots of chemicals and there were plumes in the air, and that potentially hundreds of thousands of troops could have been exposed, or tens of thousands, but we don't know who they were.
If you look at the aggregate models of the ones that DOD used and the ones that DOD did not use, it actually shows it going out into the Gulf. It covers Kuwait. In some cases, it goes up into Iran. It certainly goes down into Saudi Arabia, and most of southern Iraq is covered. So at that point, you've now reached the complete limit of understanding of how many people
are involved, because you can't even talk about troops, as the earlier discussion about what about civilian populations. Well, Sarin doesn't care whether you wear a uniform or not, but we don't know who's there. And so all we can say is everyone in this area from, you know, this time in March until this time, or from this date, or during this three-day period, or however people want to break the time down, everyone in theater has the possibility of being exposed. Yeah. And as I stated to Lord Morris, percentage in relation to dosage, to express symptoms, impossible to calculate.
Dr. Heinrich, I'm a little confused as to, this happens periodically because I'm not quite sure, when you were asked the question, is there Gulf War illness, your response to Mr. Sanders was frankly unclear to me, given that you've been involved in this process for a while. It seems to me that your answer just kind of was like blah. I mean, I don't know if you believe there's a Gulf War illness, or whether you're trying to just somehow use some technical language that says people think there is, or whatever. Do you believe there's a Gulf War illness?
The evidence that we looked at says that there are significant numbers of people that have these symptoms that we're calling Gulf War illness. And I think that the scientists, the literature shows that there's acceptance that there is.
Well, so is your trouble that we call it Gulf War illness? Did lots of people come home sick from Iraq to the tunes of tens of thousands? Do you have any doubt about that in your studies and your research?
In our review of the research, no. It's very clear that there were numbers of people that were coming back reporting these symptoms, right?
Reporting them, and in fact, hasn't it been demonstrated that they have, their reports of being sick have in fact been affirmed? They have come home sick. Is there any doubt in your mind?
No, I'm not trying to show that there's
doubt. So is the issue that whether we call it Gulf War illness or something else, is that where you get your hang up?
Well, I think that the researchers are still trying to better understand what the possible causes are, such as the neurological damage.
I guess what my problem is, it seems like an easy answer. Congressman, our soldiers reported that they came home sick. Studies have confirmed they came home sick. We refer to this as Gulf War illnesses, but we don't know what caused it. That, to me, is like the basic, simple answer. Did I say anything you would disagree with?
No, sir.
Okay. Is there anything that any of you, Mr. Bunker, I didn't ask you any questions, but I appreciated all your testimony, and I'll just say, Mr. Robinson, you've appeared before us before. You just have this simple, common logic that I wish more people dealing with this issue had. You're not emotional about it. You're just matter of fact, and it's appreciated. I just wish it somehow could get through to more people. Mr. Bunker, any comment you want to make, Dr. Hall, Dr. Heinrich, Ms. Dr. Rose, Mr. Bin, Ms. Robinson, before we close up?
Mr. Chairman, what I'd like to say is real simple and down to the point, and that is that we all know we're sick. We've been exposed to a lot of different toxins. You may never find out exactly what made us all sick. I, along with a lot of other people, want to get better. I've been putting a lot of personal effort in to try and get better. I've improved a lot since I was exposed and treated for nerve agents in the Gulf Theater itself and evac'd out. From what I am now to what I was in March of 91, I'm a whole different person. And a lot of that's myself. We need research, meaningful research into treatment. We don't give a damn what made us sick. We want to get healthy. And the VA and the DOD is not doing the job, and the funding has to be taken away from them, and the research has to be done someplace else.
Well, I'll just comment on your comment, Mr. Bunker. I didn't ask you any questions, but basically that's the theme that's come out. You kind of set it in play. And when I was speaking to Bernie, because we've been dealing with this issue so long, and it's just getting to the point of, why do we have to keep doing this? His comment to me was, the bottom line is, how do we get money to serious people to do serious research? So your point is at least reached two of us here. Dr. Hall.
Just as a final comment, I'd just like to ask the $64,000 question. That is, how many abattoir workers, how many abattoir workers, slaughterhouse men, sheep dippers, people in trades of that ilk, how many of those develop symptoms of Gulf War syndrome? The answer is zero. Could that be because none of them received multiple immunizations and vaccinations on the same day? The answer to the question may also explain why there may have been very, very few local civilians affected because of low-dose exposure. I would put money on it. Mm-hmm. It's because none of them were vaccinated against all the rules and regulations.
Dr. Heinrich, thank you, sir.
I'd like to clarify one point in my testimony, and that is the number that we used, the approximately 89,000 veterans, is from the number of people who have joined the Gulf War Registry and who sought out these full physicals for the unexplained illness. It doesn't include everybody who came back sick, because some people came back and it was clear that there was a particular cause or particular problem.
So the bottom line is the number is higher than the 89,000.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'd also like to build on what Mr. Benzet said earlier in response to the question with Mr. Tierney. I think that there's a great deal of hope in the working relationship of the advisory committee and the VA staff. I think that there are strategies there that can really be very powerful as people assess the science and really think through where it is potentially most beneficial to focus more work. But the fact of the matter is, you can't just put an announcement out there either, as they learned. You really have to seed the area with interest in the scientists so that they'll come forth and respond to those calls for research.
Thank you. Dr. Rhodes.
I would just like to echo a point that Mr. Turner made in his opening statement, and that is, if we refuse or if we don't do a good job of understanding the science behind both the modeling as well as exposure and whether Gulf War illness is tied to low-level exposure, Mr. Turner's absolutely right. We're giving our opponent a new weapon, and they'll be able to kill us over time and a long way from the battlefield. And it is an issue of taking care of our veterans, and that's the paramount issue, but it's also the issue of paying attention to what really went on and what really did occur so that we can be ready.
Thank you, Dr. Rose. Mr. Benz?
In answer to your perplexing decision-making over how to get this work done by the right people, The first issue is the amount of money involved, which, as we've said, is declining. And I agree with you that even going to the levels that were spent over the years in 1999 to 2002 is not necessarily the right amount. It could be north of that. Secondly, I would keep the money at the VA for those programs that they're dedicating to Gulf War illnesses research. If they come out with, and I say they, it should be announced within 2 months, certainly, the program that we've been working with them on, that program deserves funding. As to the rest of the funds, I agree that outside researchers should be engaged because VA is limited in the number of projects it can apply because it only can fund VA doctors. So you need to have people involved. If you want a fresh team, and first, I think DOD deserves funding for certain of their programs, such as the Chemical Defense Institute, which has done dramatically wonderful work here and which is actually being cut back, surprisingly, at this time in our history. If DOD is because of its other priorities, not able to focus on Gulf War illnesses research right now, the other logical organization is the NIH.
No, it's not. No, it's so amazing as we do happen to be in the Gulf War.
Right. I mean, we do happen to be in the Gulf, and we do happen to be involved in a war, and so on. And it just, when you say this to me, I'm doing something I don't like to do. I'm smirking. I mean, it just is. It's like, hello. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
No, absolutely. And the Congress has appropriated in the past 2 years $1.6 billion to NIH for bioterrorism research. In the 2005 proposal, there is, I think, $44 million for radiological weapons medical countermeasure research, but there is no money in that budget for chemical counterterrorism research. So NIH, both as a Gulf War illness research provider, if you will, that could contract with the best outside civilians, and NIH as a source of discovering what we can do to protect ourselves in the future better than duct tape and plastic sheeting, is definitely an avenue to consider. I think at the grassroots level, most of the people you'll be hearing from today, from those agencies, would agree with me.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Benson. Mr. Robinson, you have the last word.
I think if we go back and look at the Institute of Medicine studies that have been conducted currently, they will state, and the future ones will also state, that a lack of data collected in 1991 is going to prevent us from being able to go back retrospectively and uncover the cause for what appears to be a chronic multi-symptom illness. They just didn't collect the data at the time. They didn't do what they should have done. They didn't do medical records. That's all well known. And it's preventing us from finding maybe the cause. And we may never find the cause in some cases. However, right now, DOD is allowed to have discretion in the implementation of public laws specifically designed to prevent this event from ever occurring again. And if we allow them to have discretion in those public laws, and we let them make false statements about the risk of the exposure, we're just repeating the same mistakes all over again. And what I would encourage the committee to do is to demand tracking systems that provide meaningful data so that clinicians can cull information from it. DOD needs to sponsor treatment and research into alternative therapies that the veterans are already seeking on their own. When the veterans were met with this stone wall, they did what any person would do, is they turned somewhere else. And they have found, some of them, treatments that aren't sponsored by the VA, aren't funded as a result of their wartime service, that help them. And it cost them thousands of dollars to get this kind of treatment. But currently, the VA does not pay for it. We also need DOD to release all of the studies that have been done that were bought and paid for with taxpayer money. Specifically, one study that I'm referring to is a RAND study on the anthrax vaccine that has never been released. And what other studies are out there that have been written and never been released? So if we can continue to study Gulf War illnesses where warranted, many opportunities will still exist. And I hope this committee will pursue them, because I know we will.
Thank you. Thank you. I mean, you're triggering a conversation here. How old is the RAND study, for instance?
The RAND study for anthrax, I believe, was begun in 1999. There is a researcher that worked on it, Dr. Beatrice Cologne.
Right. Let me just say on the broader issue of lessons learned about deployment health from the Gulf War to the present, our subcommittee will conduct a briefing tomorrow at 2 p.m. in room 2247. Is that closed door? No, it's an open meeting. DOD Health Affairs Veterans Service Organization, the Institute of Medicine, and the Veterans will brief members and staff on pre-deployment physicals, medical record keeping, post-deployment health screening, and other efforts to protect the health of service men and women. Gentlemen and lady, thank you very much. We appreciate your testimony. Apologies to the second panel, but they can respond to a lot that's said here, and it would be helpful to do that. So we'll ask the second panel to come up, and thank you all in the first panel.
Thank you very much.
Our next panel is Dr. Jonathan B. Collett, Acting Undersecretary of Health, Acting Chief Research and Development Officer, Department of Veterans Affairs, accompanied by Dr. Mindy L. Eisen, Deputy Chief Research and Development Officer, Department of Veterans Affairs, also accompanied Dr. Craig Himes, Chief Consultant, Occupation Environmental Health, Department of Veterans Affairs. Second testimony is from Major General Lester Martinez-Lopez, Commander General of U.S. Army Medical Research and Material Command, Fort Detrick, accompanied by Colonel Brian Lukey, Dr. Colonel Brian Lukey, Director of U.S. Army Military Operation Medical Research Program, Fort Detrick, Maryland. Our third testimony is Dr. Robert Haley, Professor of Internal Medicine, University of Texas Southwestern Medical Center. Our fourth testimony is from Dr. Rogin Henderson, Senior Scientist, Lovelace Respiratory Research Institute. And our final testimony is from Dr. Paul Greengard, Vincent Astor, Professor and Head of Laboratory of Molecular and Cellular Neuroscience, the Rockefeller University Nobel Laureate in Medicine 2000. I don't know how many Nobel Laureates we've had. It's very nice to have you. A large panel, extraordinary opportunity to do a good amount of learning. We're going to ask you to try to stay within the 5 minutes. If you trip over a minute or so, we can live with that, but it would be helpful to kind of get into the questioning. We're happy to have you respond to anything that the other panelists said. We're happy to have you submit your testimony and speak ad lib. We're happy to have you read from notes. We're happy to have you do whatever you like within your time frame. And we'll start with, I guess, as I called you, it would be Dr. Perlin. And Dr. Perlin, you are first, and then we'll go to General Martinez-Lopez, and then to Haley, Henderson, and Greengard.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Sanders, members of the subcommittee, Lord Morris, thank you very much for the opportunity today to discuss the current status of VA's research program on Gulf War veterans' illnesses. With me today is Dr. Mindy Azens, VA's Deputy Chief Research and Development Officer, and to my left is Dr. Craig Himes, VA's Chief Consultant for Occupational Environmental Health.
I have erred. I was so eager to hear from you, I haven't sworn any of you in. So everything you've said so far is totally irrelevant.
You could have lied through your teeth.
No, I know.
Now you got to tell the truth.
Please stand. I'm so sorry. And we do know that you would come and testify and tell the truth without being sworn in, but we are an investigative committee, so it has legal implications, and we swear you in. Raising your right hand, do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you will give before the subcommittee will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Though for the record, all our witnesses have responded in the affirmative. And I also want to say to each and every one of you, we have nothing but the highest respect for each and every one of you. We appreciate your expertise. We appreciate your work. We appreciate the service you do, whether in the private sector or the public sector. And we're very grateful that you're here. So you have honored us, and we intend to listen to you and learn from you. Thank you. Bottom line is, you have introduced who was with. We'll assume that was under oath, and we'll go from there. And we'll start the clock now.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And my full record has been submitted, or I'm sorry, my full statement has been submitted for the record, and I'd just like to go over a few points. As we know, the United States deployed nearly 700,000 military personnel during Operations Desert Shield and Desert Storm in 1990 and 1991. Within months of their return, some Gulf veterans reported various symptoms and illnesses that they believed were related to their service. Of particular concern have been the symptoms that have eluded specific diagnosis. In an effort to better understand the health problems experienced by Gulf War veterans, VA, DOD, and HHS have supported research projects related to Gulf War veterans' illnesses. From fiscal year 1994 through FY 2003, the three departments have funded 240 projects at a cumulative cost of $247 million. Of these, VA funded 91 projects, eight in conjunction with DOD, totaling $53.3 million. As of September 2003, 182 of 240 projects had been completed. While each department funds its Gulf War research independently, each closely coordinates its efforts with the others to avoid duplication of effort and to foster the highest standards of competition and scientific merit. Studies have shown that some Gulf War veterans have reported a variety of chronic and ill-defined symptoms, including fatigue, cognitive problems, gastrointestinal and musculoskeletal problems, at significantly higher rates than the rates reported by non-deployed veterans. We also know that deployed Army and Air Force veterans have a higher prevalence of amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, also known as Lou Gehrig's disease. VA has sponsored several important research and epidemiological initiatives responding to the needs of these veterans. They include the following, outlined in greater detail in my full statement. $9.6 million exercise behavioral therapy study conducted between 1999 and late 2001 involving 1,092 veterans at 18 VA and two DOD medical centers. An antibiotic behavior therapy trial conducted between May 1999 and December 2001, including 491 Gulf War veterans at 26 VA and two DOD sites. The National Health Survey of Gulf War veterans and their families, which began in 1995 and has provided researchers with much valuable information, not only about Gulf War veterans, but about their spouses and children. VA's ALS study, conducted in cooperation with DOD and representing the largest prevalence study devoted to ALS, as well as VA's expansion of the ALS study to include a national registry for veterans with ALS and a genetic tissue bank for investigating this horrific disease. Although VA's and other federal research have provided valuable insight into Gulf War veterans' illnesses, much remains to be done. For example, the following are underway. New initiatives include an ALS treatment trial, expanded neuroimaging, and establishment of a dedicated scientific merit review board for Gulf War and deployment health-related research projects. VA is also funding the Gulf War health effects studies that the Institute of Medicine has been conducting. VA continues to fund the clinical health surveillance of Gulf War veterans who receive large exposures to depleted uranium oxides. VA epidemiologists have been conducting a cancer prevalence pilot study to determine the feasibility of using state cancer registries. VA appreciates and has learned from two recent GAO studies. In its draft report on federal Gulf War illness research strategies, GAO states that the VA has not identified gaps in current research or promising areas of future research. GAO also states that VA has not readdressed the extent to which the collective findings of completed Gulf War illnesses research projects have addressed the key research questions. In general, we in VA agree with GAO's recommendations in these areas and, in fact, had earlier begun to address these issues. In a second report, GAO evaluated DOD's conclusions about U.S. troops' exposures to chemical warfare agents based on DOD and Central Intelligence Agency plume modeling. It was GAO's finding that the models were faulty and recommended that VA and DOD not use the plume modeling data for future epidemiological studies. VA has concurred with this recommendation. VA has taken positive steps toward laying the groundwork for improved collaboration with Gulf War Research Advisory Committee and improving the quality of VA's Gulf War research portfolio. Research Advisory Committee will recommend scientific experts to serve as research review panel members of a soon-to-be-established Scientific Merit Review Board for Gulf War research proposals. VA will consult with the Research Advisory Committee regarding the relevancy of proposals that have been identified as being fundable. VA and the Research Advisory Committee will also work together to identify researchers who can partner with VA investigators. Mr. Chairman, let me conclude by emphasizing the following. Over the past decade, VA has supported an extensive and robust Gulf War research portfolio. We have taken positive steps to address the proposed recommendations in the draft GAO report on research related to Gulf War veterans. VA has taken positive steps to improve collaboration with the Research Advisory Committee. As VAs and other federal research programs continue to move to provide more results, we will substantially increase our understanding of Gulf War veterans' illnesses. This will enhance our ability to diagnose and treat them. All newly gained knowledge will enhance prevention and intervention in illnesses of service members in future deployments. Mr. Chairman, this concludes my testimony. Dr. Azen, Dr. Hyams, and I would be pleased to answer any questions that you or the other subcommittee members may have. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we'll hear testimony from Major General Lester Martinez-Lopez, Commanding General of the U.S. Army Medical Research and Material Command, Fort Detrick, Maryland. General.
Mr. Chairman, distinguished subcommittee members, and Lord Morris, thank you for the opportunity to briefly discuss the Department of the Army Science and Technology Program addressing Gulf War veterans' illnesses and general deployment health concerns. As commander of the United States Army Medical Research and Material Command, I am responsible for the medical research that focuses upon Gulf War illnesses and fourth health protection for the Department of Defense. In my remarks, I will discuss some of the accomplishments of the Gulf War Illnesses Research Program. My command was asked to organize and direct the research effort for the DOD in 1994, and we have made enormous progress in the past decade. We sense the frustration of this subcommittee in that no single problem or solution to our sick veterans has emerged from the research investment. This in no way should detract from the search for causes and treatments for our veterans with very real symptoms and illnesses. It is equally important that we continue to seek better ways to evaluate and predict health hazards that our young men and women may encounter in current and future deployments so that we can better protect them. As a result of the Gulf War experience, the DOD and the Department of Veterans Affairs medical research programs have grown to get closer with an unprecedented level of collaboration and coordination. For example, at this very moment, researchers from at least three different VA centers are collaborating with DOD investigators to interview soldiers at Fort Lewis, Washington, who have just returned from Iraq. This effort is part of an ambitious study jointly funded by VA and DOD to identify the most sensitive neuropsychological tests that can be used to detect early signs of a change in neurological status of soldiers following deployment. This was one of the important diagnostic gaps identified in our Gulf War experience. Another example is the DOD support to the Neurodegenerative Disease Imaging Center at the VA Medical Center in San Francisco. This center is developing state-of-the-art methods to use objective brain measurements to explain subjective symptoms of chronic multi-symptom illnesses. Currently, they are about halfway through a major study involving Gulf War veterans. Between 1994 and 2002, the United States Army Medical Research and Material Command invested $182 million to support 154 projects. We have pursued multiple lines of investigation to treat the Gulf War veterans. 38 of these projects continue, and many of these address key questions identified in earlier projects. The results of some of this research identified areas to follow up work on suggestive findings, while others rule out potential causes. For example, infectious diseases proved to be an unlikely explanation after we investigated several candidates, such as leishmania. However, our investment in leishmaniasis was important anyway, as we have encountered new clusters of soldiers infected with this parasitic disease in Afghanistan and Iraq, and can better diagnose and treat these soldiers. We supported numerous surveys of the veterans with a focus on hazardous exposures and symptoms. One study compares British Gulf War veterans with U.S. Gulf War veterans to study symptom reporting and likely exposure histories. Several large-scale focused upon nervous systems dysfunction and have either ruled out differences between deployed and undeployed forces or have discovered findings suggestive of chronic multi-symptom illnesses, including chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia. Other DOD programs, such as our efforts in Fourth Hill Protection Research, started because of issues raised in Gulf War illnesses. These studies follow up on important Gulf War illnesses studies, such as the VA and DOD study that suggests that deployed Gulf War veterans may have higher rate of ALS than non-deployed forces. We are moving on a wide front to address the issues that began with sick Gulf War veterans looking for an answer to their diseases. Our continuing research is in early detection methods, and monitoring will help identify individuals earlier ever than before, increasing their opportunities for treatment and helping to mitigate further exposures of other groups. Our continuing research on neurotoxicology ranges from the work of Dr. Paul Greengard, a Nobel laureate, to the establishment of a military version of the famous Framingham Heart Study, our own Millennium Cohort Study. In 2002, the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Health Affairs directed transition of this program to a more forward-looking effort we call Fourth Health Protection. The primary emphasis of the program is prospective, with a goal of protecting current and future service members put into operational environments. The program's scientific focus areas rely heavy on lessons learned from research on Gulf War illnesses. Mr. Chairman, this concludes my remarks, and I'll be pleased to answer your questions.
Thank you. Now we will hear testimony from Dr. Robert Haley, Professor of Internal Medicine, University of Texas Southwestern Medical Center.
Okay, there we go. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Lord Morris, in thinking through what I was going to say today, I wrote out some comments, and I'm going to summarize them briefly, but really from the point of view of trying to analyze why did our research group sort of get out front on this early and come up with clues. I think that's an important thing for us to talk about, because it's a clue to where so much of the effort went wrong and perhaps how we can bring it back to relevancy. I think the reason we got out front early is that we really had the ability to think through and try to address the pivotal questions that would drive the investigation one direction or the other. We also had independent funding early, so we were free to go ask the question that we thought was pivotal and try to get an answer. Let me talk about some of the pivotal questions. The first one is, is Gulf War Syndrome, is that is it a real illness or not? So we went out, studied a unit, a battalion, got their symptomatology and did factor analysis, which is the way you do that, and came out with very clear evidence there is a Gulf War Syndrome. There is a disease, and it appears to have three variants. Since then, Dr. Han Kang at the VA has done a nationwide study and replicated those same three factors in his study. Others have not been able to do that, but I will talk about the reasons for failure in a little bit. The second pivotal question was, is this illness a psychological illness or a reaction to stress, or is it a brain cell injury, an organic illness? And there we did studies comparing the sick and the well, those with the who satisfied the case definition of the illness versus controls, used brain imaging, the most sensitive thing that will detect brain cell injury, which is called MR spectroscopy, or it's a brain chemical analysis. And with that, we found, in fact, there's strong evidence that the basal ganglia have abnormal metabolism in the sick Gulf War veterans compared to the well. So this breaks this is a pivotal question that drives it toward a physical illness rather than stress. And there's no other way to explain that finding other than this is a brain cell injury. This finding has now been reproduced by Dr. Michael Weiner at UC San Francisco and the San Francisco VA, and the VA is now invested in his outfit with a big imaging center to follow that up, and that was a really good move that General Martinez-Lopez mentioned. And also, this has been replicated again just recently, about 2 weeks ago, an article from the University of Mississippi and the Mississippi VA found the same thing, except both basal ganglia and the hippocampus, two different deep brain structures. So it appears that we're really making progress, and the pivotal question, is it psychological or is it physical? Is it organic? Next question is, what's the basis of the actual symptoms? To show brain cell injury doesn't necessarily explain the symptoms, and so many of the symptoms we think are autonomic in nature. That is, they're dysfunction of the autonomic nervous system. You might call it the automatic nervous system. We've got a study that will be published in the next couple of months, which demonstrates definite autonomic dysfunction in veterans meeting this Gulf War syndrome. There are two other groups that have similar findings produced at national meetings. So we think that is going to explain a lot of the symptomatology and maybe provide a little beachhead for directing treatment. And then, of course, the question, are there other brain if there's one brain illness, brain cell injury, could that have kicked off a neurodegenerative disease? And that's what got us looking toward ALS, finding the first cluster, and now the VA study has come along and replicated that, so that appears to be real. Now, the next question is, is there an environmental etiology or cause of this? And of course, we then did an epidemiologic study, the first study that looked at risk factors for this case definition. And we found in our study that sarin was by far the strongest risk factor for this illness. Now, nine other studies have done this epidemiologically using self-reported reports. All of them have found that sarin is the strongest risk factor. Now, those are self-reported studies, so there's a possibility of other explanations, as you know. We also found that there's a geographical risk. That is, soldiers who were deployed up front, particularly on the fourth day of the air war, when the Czechoslovakian team detected chemical weapons, we found that group to have the highest risk of this Gulf War syndrome, which is a neurological problem. Dr. Lee Steele in the Kansas study showed the same, a similar finding. We then looked at a genetic finding. If sarin is the cause, then you would expect people who have a greater risk, a greater susceptibility to sarin would be sicker. And that's exactly what we found from a genetic point of view. The paraoxonase enzyme is the enzyme in your body that protects you from nerve gas, and Gulf War veterans meeting this case definition of Gulf War syndrome were born with low levels of this defensive enzyme. And so that connects the disease with the cause. Then I think we're going to hear later from Dr. Henderson. Her animal studies, I think, are critical. Following up about 8 or 9 other animal studies, animal laboratory studies, showing brain cell damage from combinations of low-level chemical exposures. I won't steal her thunder and talk too much about her study, except to point out that what she found in her profound study was low-level exposure to sarin produces brain cell injury in just the same parts of the brain that we found brain cell abnormality, the basal ganglia, and then University of Mississippi group found it in the hippocampus. And so there appears to be a great deal of evidence emerging that is linking all of these things up. Now, this is still a hypothesis because there's not enough replication from other studies. The reason for that is not because others have tried and failed, it's because there's no effort to replicate, and that's the problem. Now, in my handout, I went through reasons that we failed. I won't go through those again. You can read them in the handout, but I think there are 5 or 6 main reasons that $247 million worth of research sort of went off in other directions that was not fruitful. In conclusion, my main point is, I think, in looking back in the history of medicine and understanding new diseases, there are standard ways of going about it. And all we did in our studies was go about this in the way you usually investigate an epidemic of a new disease, and we found a lot of interesting things. We now see that the scientific world is starting to buy into this, is getting interested in it, and there are people who want to do research, but as Jim Benz mentioned, there just isn't funding right now. We need to fix that.
Doctor, thank you very much. Next, we'll hear testimony from Dr. Regine Henderson, Senior Scientist, Lovelace Respiratory Research Institute. Doctor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for this opportunity to speak to the subcommittee. Since the conclusion of the Persian Gulf War in 1999, there have been complaints among some veterans of diverse health symptoms that include mood changes, concentration problems, muscle and joint pains, skin rashes, chronic fatigue, sleep disturbances, chronic digestive problems, and loss of sexual drive. The cause of these illnesses is unknown, but one theory is that some veterans of the Persian Gulf War were unknowingly exposed to subclinical levels of nerve gases. Potential long-term effects of single or repeated exposures to subclinical levels of nerve gas have not been well studied. The Lovelace Respiratory Research Institute received funding through a competitive process sponsored by the Department of Defense to study the effects of single and repeated exposures of rats to the nerve gas sarin at a level that did not produce acute symptoms of nerve gas poisoning. The Lovelace studies were designed to use inhalation exposures of rats under normal and heat stress conditions to determine the interactive effect of heat stress and subclinical levels of sarin on the levels of cytokines and apoptotic cells in the brains of rats, second, on the immune system of the rats, and third, on the cholinergic muscarinic receptor sites in the brains of the heat-stressed and non-stressed rats. Rats were exposed to 1/10 and 1/20 the acutely toxic level of sarin for 1 hour a day for 1, 5, or 10 days, and observed for alterations at 1 day and 30 days after the exposures. Half of the rats were exposed under normal temperature conditions and half under heat stress conditions, that is 90 degrees Fahrenheit. None of the rats showed symptoms of acute nerve gas poisoning. There were two major findings. First, we found a suppression of the immune system. The repeatedly exposed rats, even without heat stress, showed a reduced ability to mount an effective immune response. White blood cells in the rats did not respond well to antigens. Tests were made to determine if this effect was caused by increased corticosteroids in the blood of the rats due to stress of the exposures, because you would expect if the corticosteroids were high that you'd have a suppressed immune response. But the opposite was found. The rats had unusually low levels of blood corticosteroids. The reduction in the immune response could be prevented, however, by treating the rats with a ganglionic blocker, indicating that the effects of the sarin were through the autonomic nervous system. Our second finding, which Dr. Haley has referred to, was an interaction between the heat stress and sarin in causing alterations in certain brain cells in the rats. The brains of the rats repeatedly exposed to low levels of sarin under heat stress conditions showed alterations in the densities of the muscarinic acetylcholine receptor sites in areas of the brain responsible for memory and cognitive function. Of great interest was the fact that in most cases these alterations were delayed and did not appear until 30 days after the exposures. This suggests that there may be an opportunity for intervention to prevent these effects in exposed persons. These initial studies raise many questions. What are the behavioral problems associated with alterations in the density of receptor sites in the brain? What is the temporal pattern of the response? How long will the effects last? When did the delayed effects first occur, and how long will they last? What interventions could be used to prevent the delayed effects? In terms of immunosuppression, what is the mechanism by which sarin causes immunosuppression? Does this suppression increase the susceptibility of exposed persons for microbial infections? How can the immune system be restored to normal function? And finally, is it possible that the low blood corticosteroids that we observed, if these are also observed in humans, could be used as a marker for subclinical exposure to nerve gas? As we've heard, there's a problem of who is exposed because it's not obvious since they're subclinical levels. Could this be a biomarker for exposure? At the present time, the DOD has funded us to do additional research on the effects on the immune system, and we are seeking additional funding to continue our studies on the effects on the brain receptor sites. Thank you for this opportunity, for talking to you, and we hope that the information that we have found and what we hope to find in follow-up studies will be useful for development of prevention and therapeutic measures for both our military exposed during hostile actions and for civilians exposed in potential terrorist attacks. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Next, we'll hear testimony from Dr. Paul Greengard, Vincent Astor Professor and Head of Laboratory of Molecular and Cellular Neuroscience of the Rockefeller University Nobel Laureate in Medicine 2000. Doctor?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the opportunity to testify on the topic of Gulf War illnesses. This afternoon, and in testimony presented to the committee at prior hearings, other witnesses have summarized evidence indicating that exposure of United States military personnel to acetylcholinesterase inhibitors during the first Gulf War represents a probable contributing factor to Gulf War illnesses. In fact, various of our Gulf War veterans were exposed to three distinct classes of these inhibitors, including chemical warfare agents such as sarin, pesticides, and pyridostigmine. The sarin incident, which occurred this past month in Baghdad, underlies the importance of accelerating efforts to develop therapeutic substances to combat chemical warfare agents and of developing treatments for our military personnel who have already been exposed to such agents. The good news is that we have technology available today to mount a program for the development of such therapeutic substances. The rationale is as follows. The chemical warfare agents all achieve their lethal actions by preventing the breakdown in the brain of a substance known as acetylcholine, which Dr. Henderson just mentioned. As a result, in those individuals who are exposed to these agents, there are high levels of acetylcholine in the brain for prolonged periods of time. We now have the technology to determine precisely how acetylcholine modifies nerve cells in the brain. Data already established indicate that acetylcholine can directly affect 17 distinct proteins in the human brain. These proteins are called acetylcholine receptors. It is possible, using techniques which have already been established, to identify which subset of these 17 receptors is primarily responsible for the toxicity caused by chemical warfare agents. It is also possible to determine precisely how those receptors that are involved produce the toxicity. Elucidation of those mechanisms would immediately permit a search for therapeutic agents. Such agents would have the ability to reverse the chemical changes induced in the brains of Gulf War veterans by these lethal agents. The same research should lead to the development of therapeutic substances that could prevent the lethal effects of these agents in the event of a chemical warfare attack, either within the United States or on United States citizens deployed to other regions of the brain of the world. The single major point that I wish to emphasize in this brief presentation is that the technology now exists for a rational approach to treat Gulf War illnesses and to protect our military and civilian populations from the consequences of future chemical attacks. Thank you.
Thank you. And now we'll begin question period. We're going to continue with our 10-minute question periods as with the other panel, and we'll start with Mr. Sanders.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Perlin and General Martinez-Lopez, you've heard Dr. Haley, Dr. Henderson, and Dr. Greengard give us some reasons for optimism. And yet, as I understand it, General, the DOD is putting zero money into Gulf War research this year. Can you explain to me, given the fact that we have seen some significant breakthroughs, why we would not be working with these researchers?
Sir, we're still pursuing this level of research. In other words, the research that is being done to my left by this distinguished scientist is research that's being funded and will continue to be funded by the Department of Defense. But, you know, the focus of the department has shifted to force health protection. And that may be where the many of the issues of force health protection are exactly deals with issues that are very relevant to Gulf War illnesses. So one does not eliminate the need of the other.
Okay. Dr. Perlin, how is the VA responding to the research that we've heard?
Thank you, Mr. Sanders. You're absolutely correct. The research that's been presented, these hypotheses are very intriguing and deserve further study. It's really been in this past few months that we've forged a close working relationship with the Gulf War Research Advisory Committee, and for that we greatly appreciate Mr. Ben's leadership. These are exactly the sorts of things that we want to take to further study. For example, the research that Dr. Haley described will come to further evaluation at the new Neuroimaging Center in San Francisco. Dr. Michael Weiner runs that. This imaging center allows us not only to see the actual structure of the brain in individuals who may be experiencing or who are experiencing these sorts of symptoms, but because it's actually magnetic resonance spectroscopy, actually allows us to look at the brain function. So in fact, in all of these sorts of avenues, they're really the basis for hypothesis-driven research that we can translate into a greater understanding.
Thank you. Dr. Haley, what excites me, and I think people who are struggling with Gulf War illness, is I understand it, what you are saying, that through brain imagery, you could actually see the brain damage and make a correlation between that brain damage and the symptoms that the individual is suffering. Am I right in that?
Yeah, that's correct. Brain research, neuroscience, has progressed dramatically in the last 10 years. If we had tried to address it with these techniques in 1992 or 1993, we wouldn't have had these techniques available by and large. And so there's a great panoply of techniques that are available, and there's an explosion going on right now. Every month we see new techniques. And so we now have the tools to do it, and so I think, and we have the clues, and now's the time to put money into this and study Gulf War veterans, as well as new issues, emerging issues of force health protection in the current operations. So now's the golden moment to fund research.
Okay, let me ask you a question, and I know a little bit outside of your general area of work. Is many of us have been extremely dissatisfied with the lack of progress made by the DOD and VA over the years, and we've been impressed by your work and other people's work. Give us an idea of how funding could be most effective to those people who are doing the most serious research?
It's a tough question, and I think Jim Benz really summed it up perfectly, and Steve Robinson, and the combination of their comments. I think, for one thing, I think there's been a change in viewpoint in this whole field. We see the scientific community now starting to buy into the idea that
chemical, even low-level chemical exposures in susceptible individuals can produce brain cell injury. That's no longer makes you a pariah to say that. It used to, but it's now a popular concept. And so I think you're going to see naturally the government agencies wanting to fund that research because it's not so controversial. We were at a meeting at NIH just a month or so ago with DOD people, NIH people, private researchers there, and it was just a given that nerve gas can produce, low-level nerve gas can produce symptoms and chronic illness. And
through because of brain damage?
Yes, because of brain cell, physical brain cell damage, and there's now a new alliance forming between NINDS, National Institute of Neurological Diseases and Disorders, and stroke, and Defense Department, Fort Detrick, and the Institute for Chemical Defense to look at those issues, particularly as they relate to defense against chemical terrorism.
Let me ask you this.
That is unfunded yet, but
all right, we're all obviously concerned about the potentials of chemical terrorism, but we're also concerned about a number of civilian diseases. Are you learning anything in your research that could help us with chronic fatigue syndrome, fibromyalgia, or multiple chemical sensitivity or other type diseases?
It remains to be seen because we haven't applied these techniques to those. We have plans actually to do that, and part of our funding, congressionally congressional funding through Fort Detrick is to look and compare chronic fatigue syndrome, fibromyalgia, multiple chemical sensitivity, and other similar illnesses with Gulf War illness. So we, and I'm sure others, will be doing that as well. Let me get back to the funding issue, because that's what's critical. I think what you want to see is a mosaic of funding. You don't want all the funding to be in one place. And I think that was one of the places perhaps we went wrong before. The Persian Gulf Veterans Coordinating Board that sort of oversaw all the research in the government really had a strong agenda and I think led all of that in a direction. I think what you want to see, you'd like to see NIH with this NINDS Defense Department collaboration. You'd like to see that go. You know, we have a new collaboration funding research with NIH, VA, and the ALS Association funding research on ALS. You'd like to support that with government funding. You'd like also to have some funding specifically directed for Gulf War veterans to understand that particular group and have some good oversight by the VA Research Advisory Committee, as was suggested earlier, in collaboration with VA Research and Development. That is emerging as a good model. Okay. So I think all of these ought to be supported.
Let me ask Dr. Henderson and Dr. Greengard the same question. It appears that we may be making some significant breakthroughs, not only with understanding the symptoms of Gulf War illness, but perhaps other diseases, and preparing us, God forbid, from any chemical terrorist attacks. What's your suggestion as to how we can move forward most effectively in better understanding these problems?
Well, I think you have your heavy science hitters, your heavy hitters in NIH, and you'd like to bring in that, you'd like to bring those heavy hitters in on this very, oh, I'm sorry. Get closer. Okay. I think that it would be good to bring those heavy hitters in on this problem, but you also have to have the DOD working with, collaborative with them. So I was at the same meeting that Dr. Haley attended where NIH was working with DOD together to see how can NIH contribute to this problem. I think that type of collaboration is essential. It can't just be one agency. It has to be, if it can be achieved, intergovernmental cooperation, interagency cooperation. So I would recommend that NIH and DOD work together on this.
Thank you. Dr. Greengard?
I would just as soon not get into the issues of which agencies. I get nervous just coming to Washington, let alone saying which agency should be the recipient of your beneficence. I've had very good experience with the Department of Defense in two ways. One, I had been doing some work for them in medical research in another area, not chemical warfare or Gulf War illness. And I gradually began to learn about the problems of the chemical warfare agents. And I was almost oblivious of it, as I think a large segment of the scientific population are. And much of the work that we have done in the past has been concerned with how nerve cells communicate with each other, what goes wrong in various neurological and psychiatric disorders, how drugs that affect these disorders, treat these disorders, achieve their actions, and using this information to try to develop better drugs. The situation with these cholinesterase inhibitors is quite analogous. I can take an example. For example, Parkinson's disease is associated with the loss of the neurotransmitter dopamine. And neurotransmitters are chemicals that communicate between nerve cells. You can think of victims of these chemical warfare agents as being people who have, it would be the same as if they've been congenitally consigned to a life with too much of the neurotransmitter acetylcholine. These are very soluble problems. And just like it's been possible to make great progress in understanding Parkinson's disease and finding treatments for it, it's quite analogous with the chemical warfare agents. It's no, the technology is there now. The science, the major principles of the science have been established. It's just a matter almost of engineering now to do this. The problem is that there's no money available. When I got interested in the chemical warfare problems, because they're so analogous to some of the things we've dealt with, I've talked to various people that I know in various branches of the government, and there's practically no money anyplace. This is true at NIH. Sorry.
Okay, I'm sorry. Let me just go back and conclude, going back to General Martinez-Lopez and Dr. Perlin. Do both of you now accept the premise that one of the possible causes of Gulf War illness is brain damage associated to low-level exposure to sarin and perhaps other agents?
I think there's enough science there, sir, to take that as a very serious consideration. In other words, I think, yes, there may be some soldiers from the Gulf War that were affected because of low exposure to sarin.
Okay. Dr. Perlin?
Given the research contributed by people such as Dr. Greengard, I think it is quite plausible, quite believable that there is damage from low-level exposure to nerve agents, and that can be a basis of, in fact, multiple diseases and nerve dysfunction.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Sanders.
Should I continue, sir? Or?
I'm sorry. Yes?
Yes. So we have gotten support from the Department of Defense, both in terms of a certain amount of funding for chemical warfare research, but it's been very small because they had very small pot to give money out of. And also, we have collaborated with the Institute for Chemical Defense, where we've done experiments with people there with sarin and have shown chemical changes in the brain in the same regions that Dr. Haley and Dr. Henderson talked about. Now, here's three entirely different approaches all coming to the same conclusion, that these chemical warfare agents are causing disruptions in the region of the brain called the basal ganglia, and that happens to be a region we know an enormous amount
about. These are animal studies?
Yes, sir.
What, rats is what?
Yes. They were done in collaboration with this Institute for Chemical Defense because it you can't get sarin very easily.
So you have
easily.
More or less replicated in rats what Dr. Haley has seen in Gulf War veterans?
We have replicated in rats that there is damage in this same region of the brain. The measurements are somewhat different, but a simple answer to your question would be yes, with some small caveats.
Okay, and what you're saying basically is more money is needed to continue this research.
Yes, I mean, just what Mr. Bin said, like bioterrorism, $1.7 billion to NIH, radiation, $44 million, chemical, zero. So I've been going around, and everybody says, yeah, this is really needed, and what your ideas are very, very good, let's do it. We don't have any money. Okay. Call me again next year.
Okay.
When I hear again, I'll get an even worse answer next year.
Thanks very much for your comments. Thank you. Oops.
Go ahead.
I would just like to point out one thing that may seem obvious to everyone, but and who should fund this? And the reason I said you have to have collaboration with DOD is they have the sarin. I mean, for our work, we thought about, well, we'll go to NIH for funding, and you know, you want the sarin to be under good control, and so I'm glad the DOD has it, and that's something to consider, that they have to be involved.
Okay. Thank you.
General, I have a question for you, just to follow on to what Mr. Sanders had been asking you. In reading your testimony, it reads like a great commercial trailer for what's to come. Looking at it says, expected to announce their findings within the next few months. Next sentence, the final results of this important study will be available soon. Next, this is an area for continued research. Next, we are on the edge of significant advances. Next, are providing us with a deeper understanding. You know, next one is providing new insights, but there's no conclusions. And so what I want to ask you is really a follow-on to what Mr. Sanders has said. In hearing the testimony of the three doctors who are currently undertaking research in this, did you hear anything that they told us that you disagree with or that you'd be concerned or caution us on?
Sir, research is a journey. You know, it doesn't happen overnight. And there's what we have done in the Department of Defense, by the way, just as a matter of record, most of the 154 research project has been extramural. It has not been internal to a department. We have gone to academia. We have seek people of the caliber of the people I have to my left to do that research for us. And yes, we have discovered some things, as I said before. You know, we discovered Leishmania, and at the beginning we thought there was something there, and now we don't think that's where the money is. So we know where not to look at, and now we have some good leads here that we need to pursue. But I mean, many of these are hypotheses that, you know, before we embark into treatments and solutions, we have to know for sure that that's what we're dealing with. And so that's why we cooperate with the VA system, you know, to develop a center down in San Francisco to replicate and even expand on Dr. Haley's work, because we think there is a hint there that we should pursue. So I'm optimistic, but again, I'm optimistic that we're going to find solutions. I mean, and part of the way, by the way, there's some treatments that we have found that may help people with many of the multiple symptoms, you know, cognitive therapy and some exercise. Now, how does it work? We don't know. We know that some of them are getting better. But we need to pursue far more avenues than that. We need to look at better solutions than that. So, again, I tend to be optimistic, sir. But I guess history will tell whether we're right or wrong.
Dr. Haley, Dr. Henderson, and Dr. Greengard, one of the things that I thought was important about your testimony is the discussion not only of the issue of the Gulf War veterans and the symptoms that they're experiencing, but also taking the research that you're undertaking, that you're doing, and looking at other applications that are more prospective. Yes, we have the issue of treatment of our veterans and the importance of their care, but we also have the issue of, you know, we are currently back in the Gulf again, and we have the danger of men and women in uniform who might be exposed to these agents again. We have, as you all recognize, the issue of preparedness for terrorist possible attacks in this country and in other countries. The prospects of a country using these weapons and the offensive, not just as we heard the distinction of defensive use where we've undertaken destruction of them. And also a fourth category, we have the issue of, as you, Dr. Henderson, indicated, that the Department of Defense does currently have stockpiles of these types of weapons that they're undertaking destruction of. And certainly the information as to what our tolerable levels of exposure applies to how we undertake destruction of our own weapons. And I wondered if each of you could just speak for a moment about how you might have looked in the research that you've undertaken, how it might have applications in the issue of terrorist preparedness, in the way that we're currently protecting our troops, some of the equipment that they might have, issues of what we're considering a tolerable exposure, or if you've even looked at the issues as to what we currently have as standards in the destruction and disposal of our own weapons.
Well, I think our research applies to all of those fields, and that's what makes it interesting, and that's also why you will get NIH-type scientists interested in this, because it's really basic research that tells us how the body works and how we how our nervous system works. And it can be this type of research will be of significance, as you said, for terrorist protection, homeland defense, if there's money there. We're all seeking money, of course, to continue our research, so we look for places where it might be applied. But I think this isn't just in the interest of Gulf War veterans, though it certainly is. It's in the interest of our understanding of how the nervous system works and how we can protect ourselves against terrorist attack and, as you say, disposal of weapons. So I think it's very astute you observe that. I think that, too. You want to say
something?
Well,
I certainly agree that what happened in the Gulf War is a picnic compared to what can happen. I mean, it's very possible to develop these one bit of good news, almost all of the effective chemical warfare agents belong to the same class, these cholinesterase inhibitors. So it should be possible to develop antidotes against all of that category. The one other type of is called nitrogen mustards, and they're just not very practical for a variety of reasons. So, I mean, it's a nightmare scenario what chemical warfare can do. And I have to say, as a citizen, I'm amazed how when we hear all our leaders talking about the dangers of chemical warfare, and I go around to various branches of government, they say, we have no money. We like your idea, we have no money to do anything about it.
Actually, we've spent a great deal of time thinking about that. That's another one of those pivotal questions. I think it's a critical one. And the question, I think it really devolves to the issue of, could we come up with a way of protecting people, our soldiers, for example, from low-level nerve gas or high-level nerve gas in other way other than a gas mask that you have to have on at the time that you're exposed? And with low-level, you may not know you're exposed. So one of the things we did early, after our finding about the paraoxygenase enzyme, and this gene that produces an enzyme that protects you from nerve gas. You know, in your blood, you've got this enzyme, and it destroys nerve gas when it gets in your blood. And people with low levels of that seem to have been the ones that got Gulf War syndrome. So we reasoned, what if you could boost the level of paraoxygenase in a person's blood? And so we developed a collaborative project on our campus where we took the gene, the PON gene, the paraoxygenase gene that makes this protective enzyme, and we put it on a virus, a benign virus, and put it in a gene therapy device, put it in mice, and then we showed that doubled or tripled the level of paraoxygenase in the blood of those mice. And then when you expose them to chlorpyrifos, which is a pesticide that simulates nerve gas, that you would protect the mice. The mice who had the gene therapy were protected from it compared to the controls who had the ill effects. And so gene therapy is one possible way of protecting troops. You could put a little blister under the skin that was manufacturing paraoxygenase, boost the level in their blood, and given the enzyme kinetics of this enzyme, if you just double or triple the level, you might produce almost infinite protection from nerve gas. And so, you see, that idea came from the fact that, you know, we'd done a case control study of paraoxygenase in Gulf War veterans. And so the more research you do into this, the more ideas, and then you spin off an idea that no one would never thought about. Let me make one other comment that really, I think your point is an excellent one. And, you know, the whole field of psychiatry, the psychiatric diseases, is being revolutionized by these same techniques we're talking about. What is depression? What is mania? What's bipolar disorder? What is schizophrenia? What's a phobia? You know, what are these psychological diseases that we used to think were diseases of moral turpitude, you know? What they are, it's clear that what they are is combinations of damage to brain cells in certain areas of the brain that damage receptors, so brain cells can't respond the way they should, damage to the internal machinery of certain nerve brain cells, and adaptations of the brain to those injuries, which goes under the term plasticity. The brain is constantly changing and molding and adapting to these changes. And so that's what we think psychiatric diseases are. And so sarin damage is just another one of these same illnesses of brain cells and plasticity that we may be able to prevent once we understand them. And as Dr. Greengard points out, there may be ways, as in Parkinson's disease, that we can respond once they occur. Once the disease occurs, we may be able to cure them by understanding it. But what that requires is funding. If you look back at the history of all the great campaigns that solve disease problems, my favorite one is the HIV/AIDS problem, because it started out very similar to Gulf War syndrome. It was a disease that nobody wanted to study, and no government agency wanted to fund anything about it. It was a pariah disease. And then through various political changes, it became a high priority disease. And in just a decade with very strong funding, we understand the immune system, we understand HIV/AIDS, we're coming out with a new, better treatment every year. That same story could be true of Gulf War veterans, but it's going to take a real commitment to it. And right now, that commitment to research this is not there. The Congress has not made a commitment to this. It's a dead issue, and nobody's going to fund it. We're going to move on into the future of deployment health, which is we ought to be doing too, but right now the funding is dead for Gulf War illness and for these sorts of things that we're talking about. There just isn't any money.
Thank you, Doctor. Next, I'd like to recognize again our guest, Lord Morris of Manchester, who is in the House of Lords of Parliament of the United Kingdom. Lord Morris.
Thank you, Mr. Turner. Can I ask Dr. Perlin if he can say more about the findings of the Harvard School of Public Health showing increased risk of ALS, which in the UK, as you may know, we call motor neuron disease, in veterans as opposed to non-veterans? Is he aware that in the UK we still don't regard this devastating condition as Gulf War related, notwithstanding prevalence rates no less significant than those in the US that led Mr. Principi to accept the link? Has the Veterans Agency seen any reason to reconsider that decision? Reverting to Dr. Hall's evidence today, can Dr. Perlin say how he thinks the VA would respond in such a disturbing case as his? And Mr. Turner, turning to Dr. Henderson, she referred to some very interesting research. Some very interesting research that seems extremely important in terms of linking sarin exposure to post-Gulf War symptoms. However, rats aren't humans. Is there any plan anywhere to extend or replicate this research in higher mammals, such as primates? And turning now to Dr. Haley, can he say why he thinks in the UK our studies have been so unrevealing despite such a large sample, unlike US studies? Again, if he were to study UK troops, how would he do it differently? As you may know, Mr. Turner, Professor Haley has been very widely read and is very highly regarded on both sides of the British Parliament, and it would be extremely interesting to have his comments on those two points.
Thank you, Lord Morris. You asked me two questions. One, how we would respond to situations such as Mr. Turner's terribly tragic situation, and second, to expand a little bit on our work on ALS. Let me start with the question about Mr. Turner, is that we would hope that for any veteran who presents to us in distress with disease, even if we didn't understand the etiology, the basis of that disease, even if we couldn't give it a name, that we would treat that individual, and in that we are absolutely bound lockstep with the Research Advisory Committee in seeking to find ways to effectively treat the veterans who approach us. I mean, the ALS may not have shown up in as large number in UK because, as you know, it's a horrific disease, Lou Gehrig disease, as it's sometimes known in the United States, and it is fortunately a somewhat rare disease, but it's a terribly tragic disease, and our research in large found that the rates of Gulf War veterans were approximately twice that of background population. And We have, by virtue of our electronic health record and effectively a captive population, putting together a registry. And I'd ask, you want to ask another question, but I'd like to ask after that, Dr. Aysen, who's our Deputy Chief Research and Development Officer and also a neurologist, to expand on some of the exciting work that's coming forward in ALS, both in terms of the study, understanding the molecular, the genetic basis of it, potential mechanisms of susceptibility, and new modes for treatment. But you appear to have another question, sir.
Yes, it's that, as you know, the condition is found more frequently in older people than younger people. In the case of Gulf War veterans, we're talking, for the large part, almost wholly, about younger people.
Yes, you're absolutely correct. Let me turn to Dr. Aysen to expand on both the research findings and the approach.
So the numbers are small, but I think at the moment we've identified 40 Gulf War I veterans who have ALS, and this is defined by physical examination by neurologists. And so that gives us an incidence and prevalence of about 6.7 per million as opposed to 3.5 per million. It is absolutely occurring in a younger population, and that is the finding that caused Mr. Principi to declare this a deployment-related condition and extend benefits to these veterans. We are creating the registry. We estimate we have about 3,300 veterans throughout the country who have ALS, and that includes Gulf War deployed and non-deployed. And we are creating a DNA bank. We have a number of animal studies and some new clinical trials that emanate directly from those animal studies that we are about to unroll this summer. So that would be my comments about ALS.
I really like your idea about moving up to primates. And I think whenever you do studies in rats, people say, well, what does that have to do with humans? And the primate studies in primates would be a link. The problem is funding. And right now, we're struggling to get enough money to follow up in the rats to really define what we're finding there and, you know, develop strong hypotheses that we might do in primate studies. And then I think it would be appropriate to go to primates. But they're expensive studies, and right now, we don't have that type of funding.
Can I follow that also a little bit? In just looking at Dr. Henderson's studies, there are several critical questions that need to be followed up in those studies that aren't funded yet. And we need to look at, they need to look at what other receptors are involved. They've looked at the muscarinic acetylcholine receptors, but as you know, there are dopamine receptors and other receptors that might also be damaged and non-functioning. And you need to know the answers to all of that before you go to primate studies so that you can also correlate it with similar non-destructive studies in humans. And so we're working in that direction. But that's why we really need funding now to be targeted at some of these basic questions where we've got tremendous clues, but they're just waiting to be followed up. Let me also comment on your question about the ALS study. You mentioned the Harvard School of Public Health study. That's a very confusing finding, and I would urge caution on that until we see it published, because it's fundamentally different. That study is fundamentally different from the two studies on Gulf War veterans. In the Gulf War veterans, you're looking all at military populations within the military. In that in the Harvard study that's not been published yet, they were comparing ALS in military populations, primarily from World War II in Korea, with not people who didn't serve in the military. And we know there is a very great difference between those two populations, and many reasons that you have would have different rates. For example, in people who didn't serve in the military, non-military people are by and large much less healthy, less educated, and so forth, and are more likely to die of other causes before they can die of ALS. And so you would automatically have less ALS in that population. And so until some of those issues, we have to see whether those issues have been really cleverly answered in this study, or is this just, you know, a simplistic study that found a spurious finding that they shouldn't have come out with, and that we don't know that yet. So I would urge no interpretation of that finding until we really see the results. Now, finally, you asked me a question. Why do I think the studies in the UK, the epidemiologic studies of Gulf War veterans, have been so unrevealing? And they have been. I know why. And this has affected a number of the studies in this country. The large epidemiologic studies, by and large, have been unrevealing also. And the reason for it is a very simple thing that is the epidemiology 101, we say, in the basic course that we teach students of epidemiology, that when you see an epidemic and you're trying to investigate an epidemic of a new disease, the very first thing you do is design a case definition. That is, you define the disease, you write a sentence that says a case of toxic shock is low blood pressure, red skin, and high fever. And then you go in and you apply that case definition, and you find some people who meet it, and they're the cases, and find some people who don't meet it, they're the controls, and you compare them on all sorts of things, and that's where you solve the problem. Well, early on, our Persian Gulf Veterans Coordinating Board, a strategic error in this whole thing was the Persian Gulf Veterans Coordinating Board made a policy, and the policy was there is no Gulf War syndrome. Now, in a scientific sense, we would have said, well, okay, that's fine. We'll go ahead and see if there is one. Well, no, that was a policy. And so researchers were basically forbidden, if they wanted funding, to come up with a case definition because they would be defining a Gulf War syndrome, you see?
It's called writing the minutes before the meeting.
Exactly, writing the minutes before the meeting. And so coming up with a case definition was forbidden, and so a whole generation of epidemiologic studies were done by DOD, VA, and by the King's College Group in London. They didn't have a case definition, so they were comparing surrogates of a case definition. They were comparing deployed versus non-deployed. That's too general. The few ill are lost by averaging with all the ones who aren't ill. Hospitalization and mortality were used as proxies for illness. Well, but they don't measure the illness because that isn't the disease. And so all those epidemiologic studies were a complete bust, including the King's College studies. And we've seen scores of publications from those all saying there's no problem. And the reason for it is they were forbidden to come up with a case definition and apply it in a proper epidemiologic study. As soon as case definitions were applied, we've come up with great findings. Others are now doing the same thing. We're finally off to the investigation. Now, what would I do differently? I would redo a survey in the UK in which I administer, a telephone questionnaire that where the survey has been designed in order to develop and determine a case definition, whether each respondent satisfies the case definition or not, and then you would determine the prevalence of the disease. You could then pick sick and well on the basis of that case definition and do brain imaging and genetic studies and so forth, and you would be off to the races.
I may be inaccurate on this description, but it seems to me the VA is looking at things retrospectively, and DOD is retrospective and also prospective. And I'm wondering, speaking to our military folks, if that doesn't color how we give out grants, because there's the temptation not to just focus on the veterans, but to look at the broader picture. And in the process, since DOD is the one providing some of this funding for VA, if that's not one of the explanations of why we're not seeing money get out.
I tend to believe, sir, that the collaboration and the way we go about the peer review and right now the way we're trying to work it out between the two departments will take into consideration, not only you take into consideration the gaps and you take into consideration what needs to be known, not only for yesterday to answer the mail to the Gulf War veterans, but also to answer the mail to the future, to the soldiers and that we're going to be deploying forward. So if the collaboration and the management of the portfolio works out right, and we have the right peer review process, bringing external peers like the RAC and other systems, you know, that will keep us honest, I think we can really advance and make the difference and find out the right solutions. So I'm optimistic that we're in the right track and that we can do that.
Can
Okay, I'm not quite sure how that's responding to my question, but let me ask another question, maybe we can. I'm going to read a statement. On October 30, 2002, the Veterans VA News released by the VA Deputy Secretary, Dr. Leo S. Macri, Jr., announced the Department of Veterans Affairs planned to make available up to $20 million for research into Gulf War illnesses during fiscal year 2004. However, VA has only funded one research project related to Gulf War illness research at a cost of $450,000 for fiscal year 2004. My question is, why hasn't the VA funded more than one research project for fiscal year 2004?
Well, let me just be clear on this. We could have done better. We intended to be very ambitious about this, and it was a confused period where this organization was trying to really understand the findings that it had and develop a forward-looking portfolio. In point of fact, over that period of time, and though not a justification, but simply a chronology of what did occur, there were six letters of intent to make the last merit review. Four researchers actually submitted proposals, and only one was funded that specifically applied. Our portfolio is really meant to involve three areas: the retrospective, particularly the epidemiology, the concurrent, directed very much at devising therapy, and the prospective, the clinical trials, to actually get ahead of the curve. And that really will be the basis for the forthcoming portfolio of research activity that we actually enjoy a much closer working relationship with the Research Advisory Committee on framing.
Thank you. Let me ask you this. I appreciate the honest, straightforward answer here. How is the VA notified researchers about the funding available for Gulf War illness research?
Yeah, turn to Dr. Asen on that, and we'll actually continue with some of the outreach efforts. Dr. Asen.
Sure. We do monthly conference calls. We've talked to the field at length about this. We've asked the Research Advisory Committee to help us alert people who have other talents and might not be thinking about working in the area of Gulf War illnesses to think about applying their talents into our area, into this area. I think there's a fundamental viewpoint that we are trying to convey very clearly to the entire field of VA researchers and the academic affiliates that train some of the people who then come to work in the VA, and that is that these veterans are sick. We don't know everything about why they're sick. We don't clearly have a classification for their illnesses. We don't yet have a firm idea about the neuroimaging findings, the metabolic changes, the patterns of neurodegenerative.
No, and tell me based on that, what am I supposed to conclude?
Well, okay, I think that we have gone from a philosophy that says this is not a legitimate area for serious scientists to look at, to one that says absolutely it's an area for serious scientists and clinicians to think about. And I think to that end, we are getting more and more applications, and I think we will have high quality applications to choose from, and we will have in the end, it's the dry quality merit review, the dry intellectual rigor that's going to produce real science. But I think that we have invited the field and the whole group of people in our VA field to submit applications, and we've made it very clear that quality will be funded.
If I could just jump in, I don't want to beat a dead horse here, but when you say there's been a change of thought in the VA, where previously it was not thought, Gulf War illness perhaps was not thought to be an area of serious scientific concern. I don't know what I can say, because we were up here 12 years ago anyhow, whatever it was, and we thought it was an area of serious scientific concern. We had people from the VA and the DOD, and we tried. I'm glad to see that there is a conversion, but I think it is a very sad day that tens and tens of millions of dollars essentially went nowhere because the VA and the DOD did not recognize the reality, if you like. The great debate, is it an illness? Well, of course it was an illness. We saw the people dying in front of our eyes. And it's a sad thing that it took so long, better now than never, but it is a sad state of affairs that it took so long for the VA to recognize that.
Let me just respond to that. I misspoke, and you know, I'm relatively new at this. But just to contrast the number of letters of intent that we received for the last round, which was six or four, we got 66 this time. So I think that this approach has helped a great deal. And I do not mean to denigrate prior attempts. And I think that throughout the years, the comment made about proactive versus retrospective and prospective, we've done clinical trials. We looked at antibiotics, which were the therapy that was considered to be beneficial. We looked at exercise behavioral therapy. We've been attempting these treatments. They didn't work. But science is difficult, and clinical medicine is difficult. And just because an expensive trial didn't work doesn't mean people weren't trying.
Mr. Sanders, Mr. Chairman, if I might reframe part of that, is that I think we're at a much more fortunate point now in terms of our understanding. The previous work has laid a groundwork. It's raised some intriguing hypotheses, and I'm very pleased that we have the opportunity to ask investigators not bring us something on illnesses afflicting Gulf War veterans, but we have some major leads that we can attract people to. The work that Dr. Greengard has mentioned in terms of acetylcholinesterase, acetylcholine receptor function is very promising. The opportunity to partner and really leverage the great investment of the Department of Defense and Michael Weiner's imaging, neurofunctional imaging center is really a $7 million effort. So we now have something to attract people to, and as Dr. Aysen said, 66 new letters of intent.
I think if I can, Mr. Chairman, sure. Again, I don't want to argue the past. What's important is where we go from here. But I will never forget, sitting up here, the constant resistance that we had from the DOD and the VA. Basically, they were here because we asked them to be here, but we don't really think it's probably a psychological problem or, yeah, if you force us to do something, I guess we'll have to do something, but we really don't believe it. That really was what I took out of that for so many years. But forget that. I mean, the good news, and let me just, where I think we are, and people tell me if you think I'm right or wrong, but it appears that in the last couple of years, some very, what I think everybody up there now agrees, serious scientific breakthroughs have been made, which deserve further pursuit of. And what is now distressing, if we have made, after all of these years, some major breakthroughs, what we're hearing from some of the research is, okay, we're ready to go, but we don't have the money now to do that research. Is that the fair summary of kind of where we're at, perhaps?
I think this is a very complex illness, and you heard Dr. Greengard discuss Parkinson's and the research there. We understand the neurochemical basis of that, but we don't have perfect cures. We have good treatments. So I don't want to diminish some of the importance of the research that's gone before. As you know, also, in direct response to your point, where's the money for this? Our secretary, Secretary Principi, is absolutely passionate that we do good research in the interest of veterans, in the interest of veterans suffering with Gulf War illness. And toward that end, we will be working and are working very closely with the Research Advisory Committee to find the funds to frame these sorts of promising, evidence-based, hypothesis-driven research programs. And we will do that.
I'm going to continue with my question, but my staff helped me understand what you were saying, General Martinez-Lopez. You were basically saying to me in response to the question that the coordination between the VA and the DOD and rigorous peer review will keep DOD bridge the apparent conflict between the prospective and retrospective research. That's basically what you were saying to me.
Yes, sir. Yeah. What I'm saying is that if we need to manage a portfolio, in other words, you have to manage a portfolio and do some retrospective studies still. We need to do that. But still, we need to do some basic science to understand some of the mechanisms. And we need to do some prospective treatment trials to see if they work or not. And also, with the soldiers are redeploying, as I told you in the testimony, we need to apply some of the lessons learned. In other words, do some interventions early on as they come back, to not only from the standpoint of treatment, but also from the standpoint of research, to understand better what's happening here. And that will help us to look back. So as you manage a portfolio and you peer review the portfolio, I think we'll be in far better footing to answer some of these questions from a scientific basis. Right. That is not just a department of the VA.
Right. I'm just concurring.
But there's check and balances built in.
Your response to my question was not the failure of the answer, it was the failure of me to comprehend it. So I just want to...
I'm sorry, sir.
I said your response to my question was not the failure of your response. It was the failure of my ability to understand what you were saying, and I thank you for being responsive.
I'm looking at both VA and DOD, and I'm thinking you weren't here 12 years ago or 10 years ago, and that's the good news. And no, it's really the good news. We remember when Dr. Haley was kind of like, you know, a wolf crying in the wilderness, and he had some funding from Ross Perot. I listened to him, and he seemed to make so much sense to me, but nobody else seemed to think him, you know, he seemed to be, you know, in a whole different area. And one of the things we learned, and I would just say this to the VA, what I would bring to the table was this, the recognition that as a state legislator for 13 years, we passed laws all the time about the chemicals that you could use and OSHA's requirements. And you didn't do things with certain chemicals, and yet DOD was just oblivious to this. I mean, we have one gentleman had ended up with ALS. We had someone else who, excuse me, the pilot, but we had someone who passed away in Hartford from cancer, liver cancer, and he was, you know, spraying the detainees with Winlinden, you know, for 8 hours a day with no ventilation. And there was just something intuitive. We wouldn't allow that in the private sector. And so then you have, you know, Dr. Haley talking about, you know, there is these chemicals matter. And what I want to say is, when I heard Dr. Haley and Dr. Henderson and Dr. Greengard, they basically, and this was staff again saying, you know, the last three witnesses, a powerful antidote to the stress lobby that we have been hearing from so many years. We just know that we could be doing a lot better. And I would plead with the VA and DOD to just, you know, kind of break away from the history that exists in both departments. And I'll just say one more thing to VA. When we questioned how many doctors, of the thousands that you have, and all of them well-meaning, capable, how many of them were in occupational safety, chemical side of the equation? They could only give us two out of thousands. And so, you know, there was a general feeling on our part that a lot of the doctors who were hearing these cases just didn't have the kind of experience in the background that our three witnesses at the other end of the table had. And Dr. Greenberg, you go down in record, Greenberg, you go down in record as having the shortest statement of anyone ever. And I'm not sure if that's just you're a cautious man or you're a man of few words. But I would like you to tell me, is your presence here, can I infer from that it is a not a vindication, but a, I mean, you bring to the table a Nobel laureate background. Can I infer from this that you are bringing your reputation to the table as well to say people like Dr. Haley were on the right track?
Yes, there are two issues. One is whether people like Dr. Haley were on the right track, and I believe they were. The jury's still out on the percentage of Gulf. There's no question in my mind that Gulf War illness is an illness. I mean, it's right. Absurd not to say it is. And some very bright people were misled. For example, Joshua Lederberg headed a really blue ribbon committee that he's at the same university that I am. They concluded that Gulf War illness was non-existent, that it was a stress of our troops in these very, you know, unpleasant conditions. Why they came to that conclusion, I have no idea. I haven't, you know, read all that information. The other issue, which is absolutely black and white, I bring my reputation to the table here, is that in the chemical warfare is an issue that can be treated like any other disease or potential disease. The scientific knowledge is there now to combat it. Now, so there are really those two issues. Is to what percentage of Gulf War illness is due to exposure to these nerve agents? That's one question. And then the other is, can we do anything about chemical warfare? Either by understanding how these nerve agents work, and as I said, the scientific knowledge is there now to work out what happens. We've talked about receptors, but downstream of these receptors, a bunch of biochemical steps which occur, which are being elucidated. And so there, we already know several, from this work I said we did with the ICD, several biochemical reactions, and there are undoubtedly dozens more. One can find out what those dozens are, then develop chemical treatments to prevent them. For example, let's say that these nerve agents cause too little of a certain compound, then one can use drugs that prevent the breakdown of that compound to raise it, to cure the situation. So in terms of the likelihood of success, the most likely is that we can find out how these nerve agents work and then develop antidotes which will prevent the side effects. I think that's a very excellent chance that that can happen. And it seems such an obvious thing, and I was so amazed. I've talked to several of the scientists I most respect to say, does this seem logical to you? We've gone through it. Everybody agrees. There's no flaws in this logic. So to find out how these toxic substances are working is really just a straightforward thing. The chances that based on that one would be able to develop preventatives is very good. There's a somewhat lesser chance, but still a real chance that one can develop compounds to reverse the effects of people who are exposed, by treating them shortly after an attack. And the last one, the Gulf War veterans, is certainly an enormously important problem. I'm somewhat less optimistic there, but it's still the best chance because one can find out, for example, from animals what the biochemical changes are, and we're talking about many, many different biochemical changes now, and then either by using biomarkers in living Gulf War veterans or doing autopsies on deceased Gulf War veterans, find out what percentage of those have the same biochemical changes that we can produce in experimental animals.
I'd like to conclude by just pleading with the VA and the DOD to see the opportunities here and not to, I think we've come too far and I think we've been a little too slow recently. And I would welcome you if we have to put a line item, we'll do it, but I'd like not to have to do it. I'd like to see some energy in DOD and the VA on this area that we've just talked about. I just think there'd be huge benefits to our veterans and to our soldiers of the future. I'm ready to just adjourn here. If there's any last comment, I'll be happy to hear it. Otherwise, we'll just adjourn. You all set? I think we'll adjourn. And I thank all of you very much.
Thank you.
On C-SPAN 2, a look at the Medicare Drug Discount Card Program. After that, we'll go to a forum that the National Academy of Sciences held on the Hubble Telescope. A federal judge has barred the implementation of the partial birth abortion ban. You can read more about it at Capitol Spotlight. That's at cspan.org. Today, we talked about the Medicare Drug Discount Card Program on Washington Journal. This is about an hour.
In our final hour of the Washington Journal this morning, we're going to take a look at the new Medicare Drug Discount Cards, which can begin being used today.